Sun Tzu on the Art of War by Lionel Giles. Narrated by Kenneth Elliot. Chapter 1. Laying Plans. 1. Sun Tzu said, "The art of war is of vital importance to the state." 2. It is a matter of life and death, a road either to safety or to ruin. Hence, it is a subject of inquiry which can on no account be neglected. 3. The art of war, then, is governed by 5 constant factors to be taken into account in one's deliberations when seeking to determine the conditions obtaining in the field. 4. These are 1. The moral law, 2. Heaven, 3. Earth, 4. The commander, 5. Method and discipline. 5-6. The moral law causes the people to be in complete accord with their ruler, so that they will follow him, regardless of their lives, undismayed by any danger. 7. Heaven signifies night and day, cold and heat, times and seasons. 8. Earth comprises distances, great and small, danger and security, open ground and narrow passes, the chances of life and death. 9. The commander stands for the virtues of wisdom, sincerity, benevolence, courage, and strictness. 10. By method and discipline are to be understood the marshalling of the army in its proper subdivisions, the graduations of rank among the officers, the maintenance of roads by which supplies may reach the army, and the control of military expenditure. 11. These 5 heads should be familiar to every general. He who knows them will be victorious. He who knows them not will fail. 12. Therefore, in your deliberations, when seeking to determine the military conditions, let them be made the basis of a comparison in this wise. 13. 1. Which of the 2 sovereigns is imbued with the moral law? 2. Which of the 2 generals has most ability? 3. With whom lie the advantages derived from heaven and earth? 4. On which side is discipline most rigorously enforced? 5. Which army is stronger? 6. On which side are officers and men more highly trained? 7. In which army is there the greater constancy both in reward and punishment? 14. By means of these 7 considerations, I can forecast victory or defeat. 15. The general that hearkens to my counsel and acts upon it will conquer. Let such a one be retained in command. The general that hearkens not to my counsel nor acts upon it will suffer defeat. Let such a one be dismissed. 16. While heeding the profit of my counsel, avail yourself also of any helpful circumstances over and beyond the ordinary rules. 17. According as circumstances are favorable, one should modify one's plans. 18. All warfare is based on deception. 19. Hence, when able to attack, we must seem unable. When using our forces, we must seem inactive. When we are near, we must make the enemy believe we are far away. When far away, we must make him believe we are near. 20. Hold out baits to entice the enemy, feign disorder, and crush him. 21. If he is secure at all points, be prepared for him. If he is in superior strength, evade him. 22. If your opponent is of choleric temper, seek to irritate him. Pretend to be weak that he may grow arrogant. 23. If he is taking his ease, give him no rest. If his forces are united, separate them. 24. Attack him where he is unprepared. Appear where you are not expected. 25. These military devices leading to victory must not be divulged beforehand. 26. Now the general who wins a battle makes many calculations in his temple ere the battle is fought. The general who loses a battle makes but few calculations beforehand. Thus do many calculations lead to victory, and few calculations to defeat. How much more no calculations at all? It is by attention to this point that I can foresee who is likely to win or lose. Chapter 2. Waging War. 1. Sun Tzu said, "In the operations of war, where there are in the field of thousands swift chariots, as many heavy chariots, and 100,000 mail-clad soldiers, with provisions enough to carry them 1,000 li, the expenditure at home and at the front, including entertainment of guests, small items such as glue and paint, and sums spent on chariots and armor, will reach the total of 1,000 ounces of silver per day. Such is the cost of raising an army of 100,000 men. 2. When you engage in actual fighting, if victory is long in coming, then men's weapons will grow dull and their ardor will be dampened. If you lay siege to a town, you will exhaust your strength. 3. Again, if the campaign is protracted, the resources of the state will not be equal to the strain. 4. Now when your weapons are dulled, your ardor dampened, your strength exhausted, and your treasure spent, other chieftains will spring up to take advantage of your extremity. Then no man, however wise, will be able to avert the consequences that must ensue. 5. Thus, though we have heard of stupid haste in war, cleverness has never been seen associated with long delays. 6. There is no instance of a country having benefited from prolonged warfare. 7. It is only one who is thoroughly acquainted with the evils of war that can thoroughly understand the profitable way of carrying it on. 8. The skillful soldier does not raise a second levy, neither are his supply wagons loaded more than twice. 9. Bring war material with you from home, but forage on the enemy. Thus the army will have food enough for its needs. 10. Poverty of the state exchequer causes an army to be maintained by contributions from a distance. Contributing to maintain an army at a distance causes the people to be impoverished. 11. On the other hand, the proximity of an army causes prices to go up, and high prices cause the people's substance to be drained away. When their substance is drained away, the peasantry will be afflicted by heavy exactions. 13 and 14. With this loss of substance and exhaustion of strength, the homes of the people will be stripped bare, and 3/10 of their income will be dissipated. While government expenses for broken chariots, worn-out horses, breastplates and helmets, bows and arrows, spears and shields, protective mantles, draft oxen, and heavy wagons will amount to 4/10 of its total revenue. 15. Hence a wise general makes a point of foraging on the enemy. One cartload of the enemy's provisions is equivalent to 20 of one's own, and likewise a single picul of his provender is equivalent to 20 from one's own store. 16. Now in order to kill the enemy, our men must be roused to anger. That there may be advantage from defeating the enemy, they must have their rewards. 17. Therefore in chariot fighting, when 10 or more chariots have been taken, those should be rewarded who took the first. Our own flags should be substituted for those of the enemy, and the chariots mingled and used in conjunction with ours. The captured soldiers should be kindly treated and kept. 18. This is called using the conquered foe to augment one's own strength. 19. In war, then, let your great object be victory, not lengthy campaigns. 20. Thus it may be known that the leader of armies is the arbiter of the people's fate, the man on whom it depends whether the nation shall be in peace or in peril. Chapter 3. Attack by Stratagem. 1. Sun Tzu said, In the practical art of war, the best thing of all is to take the enemy's country whole and intact. To shatter and destroy it is not so good. So, too, it is better to recapture an army entire than to destroy it. To capture a regiment, a detachment, or a company entire than to destroy them. 2. Hence to fight and conquer in all your battles is not supreme excellence. Supreme excellence consists in breaking the enemy's resistance without fighting. 3. Thus the highest form of generalship is to balk the enemy's plans. The next best is to prevent the junction of the enemy's forces. The next in order is to attack the enemy's army in the field, and the worst policy of all is to besiege walled cities. 4. The rule is not to besiege walled cities if it can possibly be avoided. The preparation of mantlets, movable shelters, and various implements of war will take up 3 whole months, and the piling up of mounds over against the walls will take 3 months more. 5. The general, unable to control his irritation, will launch his men to the assault like swarming ants, with the result that 1/3 of his men are slain, while the town still remains untaken. Such are the disastrous effects of a siege. 6. Therefore, the skillful leader subdues the enemy's troops without any fighting. He captures their cities without laying siege to them. He overthrows their kingdom without lengthy operations in the field. 7. With his forces intact, he will dispute the mastery of the empire, and thus, without losing a man, his triumph will be complete. This is the method of attacking by stratagem. 8. It is the rule in war, if our forces are 10 to the enemy's 1, to surround him, if 5 to 1, attack him. If twice as numerous, to divide our army into 2. 9. If equally matched, we can offer battle. If slightly inferior in numbers, we can avoid the enemy. If quite unequal in every way, we can flee from him. 10. Hence, though an obstinate fight may be made by a small force, in the end it must be captured by the larger force. 11. Now the general is the bulwark of the state. If the bulwark is complete at all points, the state will be strong. If the bulwark is defective, the state will be weak. 12. There are 3 ways in which a ruler can bring misfortune upon his army. 13. 1. By commanding the army to advance or to retreat, being ignorant of the fact that it cannot obey, this is called hobbling the army. 14. 2. By attempting to govern an army in the same way as he administers a kingdom, being ignorant of the conditions which obtain in an army, this causes restlessness in the soldiers' minds. 15. 3. By employing the officers of his army without discrimination, through ignorance of the military principle of adaptation to circumstances, this shakes the confidence of the soldiers. 16. But when the army is restless and distrustful, trouble is sure to come from the other feudal princes. This is simply bringing anarchy into the army and flinging victory away. 17. Thus we may know that there are 5 essentials for victory. 1. He will win who knows when to fight and when not to fight. 2. He will win who knows how to handle both superior and inferior forces. 3. He will win whose army is animated by the same spirit throughout all its ranks. 4. He will win who, prepared himself, waits to take the enemy unprepared. 5. He will win who has military capacity and is not interfered with by the sovereign. 18. Hence the saying, if you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. If you know yourself but not the enemy, for every victory gained, you will also suffer a defeat. If you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle. Chapter 4. Tactical Dispositions. 1. Sun Tzu said, "The good fighters of old first put themselves beyond the possibility of defeat, and then waited for an opportunity of defeating the enemy." 2. To secure ourselves against defeat lies in our hands, but the opportunity of defeating the enemy is provided by the enemy himself. 3. Thus the good fighter is able to secure himself against defeat, but cannot make certain of defeating the enemy. 4. Hence the saying, "One may know how to conquer without being able to do it." 5. Security against defeat implies defensive tactics. Ability to defeat the enemy means taking the offensive. 6. Standing on the defensive indicates insufficient strength, attacking a superabundance of strength. 7. The general who is skilled in defense hides in the most secret recesses of the earth. He who is skilled in attack flashes forth from the topmost heights of heaven. Thus, on the one hand, we have ability to protect ourselves, on the other, a victory that is complete. 8. To see victory only when it is within the ken of the common herd is not the acme of excellence. 9. Neither is it the acme of excellence if you fight and conquer and the whole empire says, "Well done." 10. To lift an autumn hare is no sign of great strength. To see the sun and moon is no sign of sharp sight. To hear the noise of thunder is no sign of a quick ear. 11. What the ancients called a clever fighter is one who not only wins, but excels in winning with ease. 12. Hence his victories bring him neither reputation for wisdom nor credit for courage. 13. He wins his battles by making no mistakes. Making no mistakes is what establishes the certainty of victory, for it means conquering an enemy that is already defeated. 14. Hence the skillful fighter puts himself into a position which makes defeat impossible and does not miss the moment for defeating the enemy. 15. Thus it is that in war, the victorious strategist only seeks battle after the victory has been won, whereas he who is destined to defeat first fights and afterwards looks for victory. 16. The consummate leader cultivates the moral law and strictly adheres to method and discipline, thus it is in his power to control success. 17. In respect of military method, we have firstly, measurement, secondly, estimation of quantity, thirdly, calculation, fourthly, balancing of chances, fifthly, victory. 18. Measurement owes its existence to earth, estimation of quantity to measurement, calculation to estimation of quantity, balancing of chances to calculation, and victory to balancing of chances. 19. A victorious army opposed to a routed one is as a pound's weight placed in the scale against a single grain. 20. The onrush of a conquering force is like the bursting of pent-up waters into a chasm 1,000 fathoms deep. Chapter 5. Energy. 1. Sun Tzu said, "The control of a large force is the same principle as the control of a few men. It is merely a question of dividing up their numbers." 2. Fighting with a large army under your command is nowise different from fighting with a small one. It is merely a question of instituting signs and signals. 3. To ensure that your whole host may withstand the brunt of the enemy's attack and remain unshaken, this is effected by maneuvers direct and indirect. 4. That the impact of your army may be like a grindstone dashed against an egg. This is effected by the science of weak points and strong. 5. In all fighting, the direct method may be used for joining battle, but indirect methods will be needed in order to secure victory. 6. Indirect tactics, efficiently applied, are inexhaustible as heaven and earth, unending as the flow of rivers and streams. Like the sun and moon, they end but to begin anew. Like the four seasons, they pass away to return once more. 7. There are not more than 5 musical notes, yet the combinations of these 5 give rise to more melodies than can ever be heard. 8. There are not more than 5 primary colors, blue, yellow, red, white, and black. Yet in combination, they produce more hues than can ever be seen. 9. There are not more than 5 cardinal tastes, sour, acrid, salt, sweet, bitter. Yet combinations of them yield more flavors than can ever be tasted. 10. In battle, there are not more than 2 methods of attack, the direct and the indirect. Yet these 2 in combination give rise to an endless series of maneuvers. 11. The direct and the indirect lead on to each other in turn. It is like moving in a circle. You never come to an end. Who can exhaust the possibilities of their combination? 12. The onset of troops is like the rush of a torrent which will even roll stones along in its course. 13. The quality of decision is like the well-timed swoop of a falcon which enables it to strike and destroy its victim. 14. Therefore the good fighter will be terrible in his onset and prompt in his decision. 15. Energy may be likened to the bending of a crossbow, decision to the releasing of a trigger. 16. Amid the turmoil and tumult of battle, there may be seeming disorder and yet no real disorder at all. Amid confusion and chaos, your array may be without head or tail, yet it will be proof against defeat. 17. Simulated disorder postulates perfect discipline. Simulated fear postulates courage. Simulated weakness postulates strength. 18. Hiding order beneath the cloak of disorder is simply a question of subdivision. Concealing courage under a show of timidity presupposes a fund of latent energy. Masking strength with weakness is to be effected by tactical dispositions. 19. Thus one who is skillful at keeping the enemy on the move maintains deceitful appearances according to which the enemy will act. He sacrifices something that the enemy may snatch at it. 20. By holding out baits, he keeps him on the march, then with a body of picked men he lies in wait for him. 21. The clever combatant looks to the effect of combined energy and does not require too much from individuals. Hence his ability to pick out the right men and utilize combined energy. 22. When he utilizes combined energy, his fighting men become, as it were, like unto rolling legs or stones. For it is the nature of a log or stone to remain motionless on level ground, and to move when on a slope. If four-cornered, to come to a standstill, but if round-shaped, to go rolling down. 23. Thus the energy developed by good fighting men is as the momentum of a round stone rolled down a mountain thousands of feet in height. So much on the subject of energy. Chapter 6. Weak Points and Strong. 1. Sun Tzu said, "Whoever is first in the field and awaits the coming of the enemy will be fresh from the fight. Whoever is second in the field and has to hasten to battle will arrive exhausted." 2. Therefore the clever combatant imposes his will on the enemy, but does not allow the enemy's will to be imposed on him. 3. By holding out advantages to him, he can cause the enemy to approach of his own accord, or, by inflicting damage, he can make it impossible for the enemy to draw near. 4. If the enemy is taking his ease, he can harass him. If well supplied with food, he can starve him out. If quietly encamped, he can force him to move. 5. Appear at points which the enemy must hasten to defend. March swiftly to places where you are not expected. 6. An army may march great distances without distress if it marches through country where the enemy is not. 7. You can be sure of succeeding in your attacks if you only attack places which are undefended. You can ensure the safety of your defense if you only hold positions that cannot be attacked. 8. Hence that general is skillful in attack whose opponent does not know what to defend, and he is skillful in defense whose opponent does not know what to attack. 9. O divine art of subtlety and secrecy! Through you we learn to be invisible, through you inaudible, and hence we can hold the enemy's fate in our hands. 10. You may advance and be absolutely irresistible. If you make for the enemy's weak points, you may retire and be safe from pursuit if your movements are more rapid than those of the enemy. 11. If we wish to fight, the enemy can be forced to an engagement even though he be sheltered behind a high rampart and a deep ditch. All we need do is attack some other place that he will be obliged to relieve. 12. If we do not wish to fight, we can prevent the enemy from engaging us even though the lines of our encampment be merely traced out on the ground. All we need do is to throw something odd and unaccountable in his way. 13. By discovering the enemy's dispositions and remaining invisible ourselves, we can keep our forces concentrated while the enemy's must be divided. 14. We can form a single united body, while the enemy must split up into fractions. Hence there will be a whole pitted against separate parts of a whole, which means that we shall be many to the enemy's few. 15. And if we are able thus to attack an inferior force with a superior one, our opponents will be in dire straits. 16. The spot where we intend to fight must not be made known, for then the enemy will have to prepare against a possible attack at several different points. And his forces being thus distributed in many directions, the numbers we shall have to face at any given point will be proportionately few. 17. For should the enemy strengthen his van, he will weaken his rear. Should he strengthen his rear, he will weaken his van. Should he strengthen his left, he will weaken his right. Should he strengthen his right, he will weaken his left. If he sends reinforcements everywhere, he will everywhere be weak. 18. Numerical weakness comes from having to prepare against possible attacks. Numerical strength from compelling our adversary to make these preparations against us. 19. Knowing the place and the time of the coming battle, we may concentrate from the greatest distances in order to fight. 20. But if neither time nor place be known, then the left wing will be impotent to succor the right equally impotent to succor the left, the van unable to relieve the rear, or the rear to support the van. How much more so if the furthest portions of the army are anything under 100 li apart, and even the nearest are separated by several li. 21. Though according to my estimate, the soldiers of Yui exceed our own in number, that shall advantage them nothing in the matter of victory. I say then that victory can be achieved. 22. Though the enemy be stronger in numbers, we may prevent him from fighting. Scheme so as to discover his plans and the likelihood of their success. 23. Rouse him and learn the principle of his activity or inactivity. Force him to reveal himself, so as to find out his vulnerable spots. 24. Carefully compare the opposing army with your own, so that you may know where strength is superabundant and where it is deficient. 25. In making tactical dispositions, the highest pitch you can attain is to conceal them. Conceal your dispositions, and you will be safe from the prying of the subtlest spies, from the machinations of the wisest brains. 26. how victory may be produced for them out of the enemy's own tactics. That is what the multitude cannot comprehend. 27. All men can see the tactics whereby I conquer, but what none can see is the strategy out of which victory is evolved. 28. Do not repeat the tactics which have gained you one victory, but let your methods be regulated by the infinite variety of circumstances. 29. Military tactics are like unto water, for water in its natural course runs away from high places and hastens downwards. 30. So in war, the way is to avoid what is strong and to strike at what is weak. 31. Water shapes its course according to the nature of the ground over which it flows. The soldier works out his victory in relation to the foe whom he is facing. 32. Therefore, just as water retains no constant shape, so in warfare there are no constant conditions. 33. He who can modify his tactics in relation to his opponent and thereby succeed in winning may be called a heaven-born captain. 34. The five elements, water, fire, wood, metal, earth, are not always equally predominant. The four seasons make way for each other in turn. There are short days and long. The moon has its periods of waning and waxing. Chapter 7. Maneuvering. 1. Sun Tzu said, "In war, the general receives his commands from the sovereign." 2. Having collected an army and concentrated his forces, he must blend and harmonize the different elements thereof before pitching his camp. 3. After that comes tactical maneuvering, than which there is nothing more difficult. The difficulty of tactical maneuvering consists in turning the devious into the direct and misfortune into gain. 4. Thus to take a long and circuitous route, after enticing the enemy out of the way, and though starting after him to contrive to reach the goal before him, shows knowledge of the artifice of deviation. 5. Maneuvering with an army is advantageous, with an undisciplined multitude, most dangerous. 6. If you set a fully equipped army in march in order to snatch an advantage, the chances are that you will be too late. On the other hand, to detach a flying column for the purpose involves the sacrifice of its baggage and stores. 7. Thus, if you order your men to roll up their buff coats and make forced marches without halting day or night, covering double the usual distance at a stretch, doing 100 li in order to wrest an advantage, the leaders of all your 3 divisions will fall into the hands of the enemy. 8. The stronger men will be in front, the jaded ones will fall behind, and on this plan only 1/10 of your army will reach its destination. 9. If you march 50 li in order to outmaneuver the enemy, you will lose the leader of your first division and only half your force will reach the goal. 10. If you march 30 li with the same object, 2/3 of your army will arrive. 11. We may take it then that an army without its baggage train is lost. Without provisions, it is lost. Without bases of supply, it is lost. 12. We cannot enter into alliances until we are acquainted with the designs of our neighbors. 13. We are not fit to lead an army on the march unless we are familiar with the face of the country, its mountains and forests, its pitfalls and precipices, its marshes and swamps. 14. We shall be unable to turn natural advantage to account unless we make use of local guides. 15. In war, practice dissimulation and you will succeed. 16. Whether to concentrate or to divide your troops must be decided by circumstances. 17. Let your rapidity be that of the wind, your compactness that of the forest. 18. In raiding and plundering, be like fire, in immovability like a mountain. 19. Let your plans be dark and impenetrable as night, and when you move, fall like a thunderbolt. 20. When you plunder a countryside, let the spoil be divided amongst your men. When you capture new territory, cut it up into allotments for the benefit of the soldiery. 21. Ponder and deliberate before you make a move. 22. He will conquer who has learnt the artifice of deviation, such as the art of maneuvering. 23. The Book of Army Management says, on the field of battle, the spoken word does not carry far enough, hence the institution of gongs and drums, nor can ordinary objects be seen clearly enough, hence the institution of banners and flags. 24. Gongs and drums, banners and flags, are means whereby the ears and eyes of the host may be focused on one particular point. 25. The host thus forming a single united body, is it impossible either for the brave to advance alone, or for the cowardly to retreat alone? This is the art of handling large masses of men. 26. In night fighting, then make much use of signal fires and drums, and in fighting by day of flags and banners as a means of influencing the ears and eyes of your army. 27. A whole army may be robbed of its spirit. A commander-in-chief may be robbed of his presence of mind. 28. Now a soldier's spirit is keenest in the morning. By noonday it has begun to flag, and in the evening his mind is bent only on returning to camp. 29. A clever general, therefore, avoids an army when its spirit is keen, but attacks it when it is sluggish and inclined to return. This is the art of studying moods. 30. Disciplined and calm, to await the appearance of disorder and hubbub amongst the enemy, this is the art of retaining self-possession. 31. To be near the goal while the enemy is still far from it, to wait at ease while the enemy is toiling and struggling, to be well fed while the enemy is famished, this is the art of husbanding one's strength. 32. To refrain from intercepting an enemy whose banners are in perfect order, to refrain from attacking an army drawn up in calm and confident array, this is the art of studying circumstances. 33. It is a military axiom not to advance uphill against the enemy, nor to oppose him when he comes downhill. 34. Do not pursue an enemy who simulates flight. Do not attack soldiers whose temper is keen. 35. Do not swallow bait offered by the enemy. Do not interfere with an army that is returning home. 36. When you surround an army, leave an outlet free. Do not press a desperate foe too hard. 37. Such is the art of warfare. Chapter 8. Variation of Tactics. Sun Tzu said, in war, the general receives his commands from the sovereign, collects his army, and concentrates his forces. 2. When in difficult country, do not encamp. In country where high roads intersect, join hands with your allies. Do not linger in dangerously isolated positions. In hemmed-in situations, you must resort to stratagem. In desperate position, you must fight. 3. There are roads which must not be followed, armies which must not be attacked, towns which must not be besieged, positions which must not be contested, commands of the sovereign which must not be obeyed. 4. The general who thoroughly understands the advantages that accompany variation of tactics knows how to handle his troops. 5. The general who does not understand these may be well acquainted with the configuration of the country, yet he will not be able to turn his knowledge into practical account. 6. So the student of war, who is unversed in the art of war, of varying his plans, even though he be acquainted with the five advantages, will fail to make the best use of his men. 7. Hence, in the wise leader's plans, considerations of advantage and of disadvantage will be blended together. 8. If our expectation of advantage be tempered in this way, we may succeed in accomplishing the essential part of our schemes. 9. If, on the other hand, in the midst of difficulties we are always ready to seize an advantage, we may extricate ourselves from misfortune. 10. Reduce the hostile chiefs by inflicting damage on them, and make trouble for them, and keep them constantly engaged. Hold out specious allurements and make them rush to any given point. 11. The art of war teaches us to rely not on the likelihood of the enemy's not coming, but on our own readiness to receive him. Not on the chance of his not attacking, but rather on the fact that we have made our position unassailable. 12. There are five dangerous faults which may affect a general. 1. Recklessness, which leads to destruction. 2. Cowardice, which leads to capture. 3. A hasty temper, which can be provoked by insults. 4. A delicacy of honor, which is sensitive to shame. 5. Over-solicitude for his men, which exposes him to worry and trouble. 13. These are the five besetting sins of a general, ruinous to the conduct of war. 14. When an army is overthrown and its leader slain, the cause will surely be found among these five dangerous faults. Let them be a subject of meditation. Chapter 9. The Army on the March. 1. Sun Tzu said, "We come now to the question of encamping the army and observing signs of the enemy. Pass quickly over mountains and keep in the neighborhood of valleys. 2. Camp in high places, facing the sun. Do not climb heights in order to fight. So much for mountain warfare. 3. After crossing a river, you should get far away from it. 4. When an invading force crosses a river in its onward march, do not advance to meet it in midstream. It will be best to let half the army get across and then deliver your attack. 5. If you are anxious to fight, you should not go to meet the invader near a river which he has to cross. 6. Moor your craft higher up than the enemy and facing the sun. Do not move upstream to meet the enemy. So much for river warfare. 7. In crossing salt marshes, your sole concern should be to get over them quickly without any delay. 8. If forced to fight in a salt marsh, you should have water and grass near you and get your back to a clump of trees. So much for operations in salt marches. 9. In dry, level country, take up an easily accessible position with rising ground to your right and on your rear, so that the danger may be in front and safety lie behind, so much for campaigning in flat country. 10. These are the four useful branches of military knowledge which enabled the Yellow Emperor to vanquish four several sovereigns. 11. All armies prefer high ground to low and sunny places to dark. 12. If you are careful of your men and camp on hard ground, the army will be free from disease of every kind, and this will spell victory. 13. When you come to a hill or a bank, occupy the sunny side with the slope on your right rear. Thus you will at once act for the benefit of your soldiers and utilize the natural advantages of the ground. 14. When in consequence of heavy rains up country, a river which you wish to ford is swollen and flecked with foam, you must wait until it subsides. 15. Country in which there are precipitous cliffs with torrents running between, deep natural hollows, confined places, tangled thickets, quagmires, and crevices, should be left with all possible speed and not approached. 16. While we keep away from such places, we should get the enemy to approach them. While we face them, we should let the enemy have them on his rear. 17. If in the neighborhood of your camp there should be any hilly country, ponds surrounded by aquatic grass, hollow basins filled with reeds, or woods with thick undergrowth, they must be carefully routed out and searched. For these are places where men in ambush or insidious spies are likely to be lurking. 18. When the enemy is close at hand and remains quiet, he is relying on the natural strength of his position. 19. When he keeps aloof and tries to provoke a battle, he is anxious for the other side to advance. 20. If his place of encampment is easy of access, he is tendering a bait. 21. Movement amongst the trees of a forest shows that the enemy is advancing. The appearance of a number of screens in the midst of thick grass means that the enemy wants to make us suspicious. 22. The rising of birds in their flight is the sign of an ambuscade. Startled beasts indicate that a sudden attack is coming. 23. When there is dust rising in a high column, it is the sign of chariots advancing. When the dust is low but spread over a wide area, it betokens the approach of infantry. When it branches out in different directions, it shows that parties have been sent to collect firewood. A few clouds of dust moving to and fro signify that the army is encamping. 24. Humble words and increased preparations are signs that the enemy is about to advance. Violent language and driving forward as if to the attack are signs that he will retreat. 25. When the light chariots come out first and take up a position on the wings, it is a sign that the enemy is forming for battle. 26. Peace proposals unaccompanied by a sworn covenant indicate a plot. 27. When there is much running about and the soldiers fall into rank, it means that the critical moment has come. 28. When some are seen advancing and some retreating, it is a lure. 29. When the soldiers stand leaning on their spears, they are faint from want of food. 30. If those who are sent to draw water begin by drinking themselves, the army is suffering from thirst. 31. If the enemy sees an advantage to be gained and makes no effort to secure it, the soldiers are exhausted. 32. If birds gather on any spot, it is unoccupied. Clamor by night betokens nervousness. 33. If there is disturbance in the camp, the general's authority is weak. If the banners and flags are shifted about, sedition is afoot. If the officers are angry, it means that the men are weary. 34. When an army feeds its horses with grain and kills its cattle for food, and when the men do not hang their cooking pots over the campfires, showing that they will not return to their tents, you may know that they are determined to fight to the death. 35. The sight of men whispering together in small knots or speaking in subdued tones points to dissatisfaction amongst the rank and file. 36. Too frequent rewards signify that the enemy is at the end of his resources. Too many punishments betray a condition of dire distress. 37. To begin by bluster, but afterwards to take fright at the enemy's numbers, shows a supreme lack of intelligence. 38. When envoys are sent with compliments in their mouths, it is a sign that the enemy wishes for a truce. 39. If the enemy's troops march up angrily and remain facing ours for a long time without either joining battle or taking themselves off again, the situation is one that demands great vigilance and circumspection. 40. If our troops are no more in number than the enemy, that is amply sufficient. It only means that no direct attack can be made. What we can do is simply to concentrate all our available strength keep a close watch on the enemy, and obtain reinforcements. 41. He who exercises no forethought but makes light of his opponents is sure to be captured by them. 42. If soldiers are punished before they have grown attached to you, they will not prove submissive, and unless submissive, then will be practically useless. If, when the soldiers have become attached to you, punishments are not enforced, they will still be useless. 43. Therefore, soldiers must be treated in the first instance with humanity, but kept under control by means of iron discipline. This is a certain road to victory. 44. If in training, soldiers' commands are habitually enforced, the army will be well disciplined. If not, its discipline will be bad. 45. If a general shows confidence in his men but always insists on his orders being obeyed, the gain will be mutual. Chapter 10. Terrain. 1. Sun Tzu said, "We may distinguish six kinds of terrain, to wit. 1. Accessible ground. 2. Entangled ground. 3. Temporizing ground. 4. Narrow passes. 5. Precipitous heights. 6. Positions at a great distance from the enemy. 2. Ground which can be freely traversed by both sides is called accessible. 3. With regard to ground of this nature, be before the enemy in occupying the raised and sunny spots and carefully guard your line of supplies. Then you will be able to fight with advantage. 4. Ground which can be abandoned but is hard to reoccupy is called entangling. 5. From a position of this sort, if the enemy is unprepared, you may sally forth and defeat him. But if the enemy is prepared for your coming and you fail to defeat him, then return, being impossible, disaster will ensue. 6. When the position is such that neither side will gain by making the first move, it is called temporizing ground. 7. In a position of this sort, even though the enemy should offer us an attractive bait, it will be advisable not to stir forth, but rather to retreat, thus enticing the enemy in his turn. Then, when part of his army has come out, we may deliver our attack with advantage. 8. With regard to narrow passes, if you can occupy them first, let them be strongly garrisoned and await the advent of the enemy. 9. Should the enemy forestall you in occupying a pass, do not go after him if the pass is fully garrisoned, but only if it is weakly garrisoned. 10. With regard to precipitous heights, if you are beforehand with your adversary, you should occupy the raised and sunny spots, and there wait for him to come up. 11. If the enemy has occupied them before you, do not follow him, but retreat and try to entice him away. 12. If you are suited at a great distance from the enemy and the strength of the two armies is equal, it is not easy to provoke a battle, and fighting will be to your disadvantage. 13. These six are the principles connected with earth. The general who has attained a responsible post must be careful to study them. 14. Now an army is exposed to six several calamities, not arising from natural causes, but from faults for which the general is responsible. These are 1. Flight, 2. Insubordination, 3. Collapse, 4. Ruin, 5. Disorganization, 6. Rout. 15. Other conditions being equal, if one force is hurled against another 10 times its size, the result will be the flight of the former. 16. When the common soldiers are too strong and their officers too weak, the result is insubordination. When the officers are too strong and the common soldiers are too weak, the result is collapse. 17. When the higher officers are angry and insubordinate, and on meeting the enemy give battle on their own account from a feeling of resentment, before the commander-in-chief can tell whether or no he is in a position to fight, the result is ruin. 18. When the general is weak and without authority, when his orders are not clear and distinct, when there are no fixes duties assigned to officers and men, and the ranks are formed in a slovenly, haphazard manner, the result is utter disorganization. 19. When a general, unable to estimate the enemy's strength, allows an inferior force to engage a larger one, or hurls a weak detachment against a powerful one, and neglects to place picked soldiers in the front rank, the result must be rout. 20. These are 6 ways of courting defeat, which must be carefully noted by the general who has attained a responsible post. 21. The natural formation of the country is the soldier's best ally, but a power of estimating the adversary, of controlling the forces of victory, and of shrewdly calculating difficulties, dangers, and distances constitutes the test of a great general. 22. He who knows these things, and in fighting puts his knowledge into practice, will win his battles. He who knows them not, nor practices them, will surely be defeated. 23. If fighting is sure to result in victory, then you must fight, even though the ruler forbid it. If fighting will not result in victory, then you must not fight, even at the ruler's bidding. 24. The general who advances without coveting fame and retreats without fearing disgrace, whose only thought is to protect his country and do good service for his sovereign, is the jewel of the kingdom. 25. Regard your soldiers as your children, and they will follow you into the deepest valleys. Look upon them as your own beloved sons, and they will stand by you even unto death. 26. If, however, you are indulgent, but unable to make your authority felt, kind-hearted, but unable to enforce your commands, and incapable, moreover, of quelling disorder, then your soldiers must be likened to spoilt children. They are useless for any practical purpose. 27. If we know that our own men are in a condition to attack, but are unaware that the enemy is not open to attack, we have gone only halfway towards victory. 28. If we know that the enemy is open to attack, but are unaware that our own men are not in a condition to attack, we have gone only halfway towards victory. 29. If we know that the enemy is open to attack, and also know that our men are in a condition to attack, but are unaware that the nature of the ground makes fighting impracticable, we have still gone only halfway towards victory. 30. Hence the experienced soldier, once in motion, is never bewildered. Once he has broken camp, he is never at a loss. 31. Hence the saying, if you know the enemy and know yourself, your victory will not stand in doubt. If you know heaven and know earth, you may make your victory complete. Chapter 11. The Nine Situations. 1. Sun Tzu said, the art of war recognizes 9 varieties of ground. 1. Dispersive ground. 2. Facile ground. 3. Contentious ground. 4. Open ground. 5. Ground of intersecting highways. 6. Serious ground. 7. Difficult ground. 8. Hemmed in ground. 9. Desperate ground. 2. When a chieftain is fighting in his own territory, it is dispersive ground. 3. When he is penetrated into hostile territory, but to no great distance, it is facile ground. 4. Ground the possession of which imports great advantage to either side is contentious ground. 5. Ground on which each side has liberty of movement is open ground. 6. Ground which forms the key to 3 contiguous states, so that he who occupies it first has most of the empire at his command, is a ground of intersecting highways. 7. When an army has penetrated into the heart of a hostile country, leaving a number of fortified cities in its rear, it is serious ground. 8. Mountain forests, rugged steeps, marshes, and fens, all country that is hard to traverse, this is difficult ground. 9. Ground which is reached through narrow gorges, and from which we can only retire by tortuous paths, so that a small number of the enemy would suffice to crush a large body of our men, this is hemmed-in ground. 10. Ground on which we can only be saved from destruction by fighting without delay is desperate ground. 11. On dispersive ground, therefore, fight not. On facile ground, halt not. On contentious ground, attack not. 12. On open ground, do not try to block the enemy's way. On the ground of intersecting highways, join hands with your allies. 13. On serious ground, gather in plunder. In difficult ground, keep steadily on the march. 14. On hemmed-in ground, resort to stratagem. On desperate ground, fight. 15. Those who were called skillful leaders of old knew how to drive a wedge between the enemy's front and rear, to prevent cooperation between his large and small divisions, to hinder the good troops from rescuing the bad, the officers from rallying their men. 16. When the enemy's men were united, they managed to keep them in disorder. 17. When it was to their advantage, they made a forward move. When otherwise, they stopped still. 18. If asked how to cope with a great host of the enemy in orderly array and on the point of marching to the attack, I should say, begin by seizing something which your opponent holds dear, then he will be amenable to your will. 19. Rapidity is the essence of war. Take advantage of the enemy's unreadiness. Make your way by unexpected routes and attack unguarded spots. 20. The following are the principles to be observed by an invading force. The further you penetrate into a country, the greater will be the solidarity of your troops, and thus the defenders will not prevail against you. 21. Make forays in fertile country in order to supply your army with food. 22. Carefully study the well-being of your men, and do not overtax them. Concentrate your energy and hoard your strength. Keep your army continually on the move and devise unfathomable plans. 23. Throw your soldiers into positions whence there is no escape, and they will prefer death to flight. If they will face death, there is nothing they may not achieve. Officers and men alike will put forth their uttermost strength. 24. Soldiers, when in desperate straits, lose the sense of fear. If there is no place of refuge, they will stand firm. If they are in hostile country, they will show a stubborn front. If there is no help for it, they will fight hard. 25. Thus, without waiting to be marshaled, the soldiers will be constantly on the qui-vive. Without waiting to be asked, they will do your will. Without restrictions, they will be faithful. Without giving orders, they can be trusted. 26. Prohibit the taking of omens, and do away with superstitious doubts. Then, until death itself comes, no calamity need be feared. 27. If our soldiers are not overburdened with money, it is not because they have a distaste for riches. If their lives are not unduly long, it is not because they are disinclined to longevity. 28. On the day they are ordered out to battle, your soldiers may weep. Those sitting up bedewing their garments, and those lying down letting the tears run down their cheeks. But let them once be brought to bay, and they will display the courage of a Chu or a Kuei. 29. The skillful tactician may be likened to the Shuazhan. Now the Shuazhan is a snake that is found in the Chang Mountains. Strike at its head, and you will be attacked by its tail. Strike at its tail, and you will be attacked by its head. Strike at its middle, and you will be attacked by head and tail both. 30. Asked if an army can be made to imitate the Shuazhan, I should answer yes, For the men of Wu and the men of Yio are enemies. Yet, if they are crossing a river in the same boat and are caught by a storm, they will come to each other's assistance just as the left hand helps the right. 31. Hence, it is not enough to put one's trust in the tethering of horses and the burying of chariot wheels in the ground. 32. The principle on which to manage an army is to set up one standard of courage which all must reach. 33. How to make the best of both strong and weak, that is a question involving the proper use of ground. 34. Thus the skillful general conducts his army just as though he were leading a single man, willy-nilly, by the hand. 35. It is the business of a general to be quiet and thus ensure secrecy, upright and just, and thus maintain order. 36. He must be able to mystify his officers and men by false reports and appearances, and thus keep them in total ignorance. 37. By altering his arrangements and changing his plans, he keeps the enemy without definite knowledge. By shifting his camp and taking circuitous routes, he prevents the enemy from anticipating his purpose. 38. At the critical moment, the leader of an army acts like one who has climbed up a height and then kicks away the ladder behind him. He carries his men deep into hostile territory before he shows his hand. 39. He burns his boats and breaks his cooking pots like a shepherd driving a flock of sheep. He drives his men this way and that, and nothing knows whither he is going. 40. To muster his host and bring it into danger, this may be termed the business of the general. 41. The different measures suited to the 9 varieties of ground. The expediency of aggressive or defensive tactics, and the fundamental laws of human nature, these are things that must most certainly be studied. 42. When invading hostile territory, the general principle is that penetrating deeply brings cohesion, penetrating but a short way means dispersion. 43. When you leave your own country behind and take your army across neighborhood territory, you find yourself on critical ground. When there are means of communication on all 4 sides, the ground is one of intersecting highways. 44. When you penetrate deeply into a country, it is serious ground. When you penetrate but a little way, it is facile ground. 45. When you have the enemy's strongholds on your rear and narrow passes in front, it is hemmed-in ground. When there is no place of refuge at all, it is desperate ground. 46. Therefore, on dispersive ground, I would inspire my men with unity of purpose. On facile ground, I would see that there is close connection between all parts of my army. 47. On contentious ground, I would hurry up my rear. 48. On open ground, I would keep a vigilant eye on my defenses. On ground of intersecting highways, I would consolidate my alliances. 49. On serious ground, I would try to ensure a continuous stream of supplies. On difficult ground, I would keep pushing on along the road. 50. On hemmed-in ground, I would block any way of retreat. On desperate ground, I would proclaim to my soldiers the hopelessness of saving their lives. 51. For it is the soldier's disposition to offer an obstinate resistance when surrounded, to fight hard when he cannot help himself, and to obey promptly when he has fallen into danger. 52. We cannot enter into alliance with neighboring princes until we are acquainted with their designs. We are not fit to lead an army on the march unless we are familiar with the face of the country, its mountains and forests, its pitfalls and precipices, its marshes and swamps. We shall be unable to turn natural advantages to account unless we make use of local guides. 53. To be ignored of any of the following 4 or 5 principles does not befit a warlike prince. 54. When a warlike prince attacks a powerful state, his generalship shows itself in preventing the concentration of the enemy's forces. He overawes his opponents, and their allies are prevented from joining against him. 55. Hence he does not strive to ally himself with all and sundry, nor does he foster the power of other states. He carries out his own secret designs, keeping his antagonists in awe. Thus he is able to capture their cities and overthrow their kingdoms. 56. Bestow rewards without regard to rule. Issue orders without regard to previous arrangements, and you will be able to handle a whole army as though you had to do with but a single man. 57. Confront your soldiers with the deed itself. Never let them know your design. When the outlook is bright, bring it before their eyes, but tell them nothing when the situation is gloomy. 58. Place your army in deadly peril, and it will survive. Plunge it into desperate straits, and it will come off in safety. 59. For it is precisely when a force has fallen into harm's way that is capable of striking a blow for victory. 60. Success in warfare is gained by carefully accommodating ourselves to the enemy's purpose. 61. By persistently hanging on the enemy's flank, we shall succeed in the long run in killing the commander-in-chief. 62. This is called ability to accomplish a thing by sheer cunning. 63. On the day that you take up your command, block the frontier passes, destroy the official tallies, and stop the passage of all emissaries. 64. Be stern in the council chamber so that you may control the situation. 65. If the enemy leaves a door open, you must rush in. 66. Forestall your opponent by seizing what he holds dear, and subtly contrive to time his arrival on the ground. 67. Chapter 12. The Attack by Fire. 1. Sun Tzu said, "There are 5 ways of attacking with fire. The first is to burn soldiers in their camp. The second is to burn stores. The third is to burn baggage trains. The fourth is to burn arsenals and magazines. The fifth is to hurl dropping fire amongst the enemy." 2. In order to carry out an attack, we must have means available. The material for raising fire should always be kept in readiness. 3. There is a proper season for making attacks with fire, and special days for starting a conflagration. 4. The proper season is when the weather is very dry. The special days are those when the moon is in the constellations of the sieve, the wall, the wing, or the crossbar. For these 4 are all days of rising wind. 5. In attacking with fire, one should be prepared to meet 5 possible developments. 6. 1. When fire breaks out inside to enemy's camp, respond at once with an attack from without. 7. 2. If there is an outbreak of fire, but the enemy's soldiers remain quiet, bide your time and do not attack. 8. 3. When the force of the flames has reached its height, follow it up with an attack. If that is practicable, if not, stay where you are. 9. 4. If it is possible to make an assault with fire from without, do not wait for it to break out within, but deliver your attack at a favorable moment. 10. 5. When you start a fire, be to windward of it. Do not attack from the leeward. 11. A wind that rises in the daytime lasts long, but a night breeze soon falls. 12. In every army, the 5 developments connected with fire must be known, the movements of the stars calculated, and a watch kept for the proper days. 13. Hence those who use fire as an aid to the attack show intelligence. Those who use water as an aid to the attack gain an accession of strength. 14. By means of water, An enemy may be intercepted, but not robbed of all his belongings. 15. Unhappy is the fate of one who tries to win his battles and succeed in his attacks without cultivating the spirit of enterprise, for the result is waste of time and general stagnation. 16. Hence the saying, the enlightened ruler lays his plans well ahead, the good general cultivates his resources. 17. Move not unless you see an advantage. Use not your troops unless there is something to be gained. Fight not unless the position is critical. 18. No ruler should put troops into the field merely to gratify his own spleen. No general should fight a battle simply out of pique. 19. If it is to your advantage, make a forward move. If not, stay where you are. 20. Anger may in time change to gladness. Vexation may be succeeded by content. 21. But a kingdom that has once been destroyed can never come again into being, nor can the dead ever be brought back to life. 22. Hence the enlightened ruler is heedful, and the good general full of caution. This is the way to keep a country at peace and an army intact. Chapter 13. The Use of Spies. 1. Sun Tzu said, raising a host of 100,000 men and marching them great distances entails heavy loss on the people and a drain on the resources of the state. The daily expenditure will amount to 1,000 ounces of silver. There will be commotion at home and abroad, and men will drop down exhausted on the highways. As many as 700,000 families will be impeded in their labor. 2. Hostile armies may face each other for years, striving for the victory which is decided in a single day. This being so, to remain in ignorance of the enemy's condition simply because one grudges the outlay of 100 ounces of silver in honors and emoluments is the height of inhumanity. 3. One who acts thus is no leader of men, no present help to his sovereign, no master of victory. 4. Thus, what enables the wise sovereign and the good general to strike and conquer and achieve things beyond the reach of ordinary men is foreknowledge. 5. Now, this foreknowledge cannot be elicited from spirits, it cannot be obtained inductively from experience, nor by any deductive calculation. 6. Knowledge of the enemy's dispositions can only be obtained from other men. 7. Hence the use of spies, of whom there are 5 classes, 1. Local spies, 2. Inward spies, 3. Converted spies, 4. Doomed spies, 5. Surviving spies. 8. When these 5 kinds of spy are all at work, none can discover the secret system. This is called divine manipulation of the threads. It is the sovereign's most precious faculty. 9. Having local spies means employing the services of the inhabitants of a district. 10. Having inward spies, making use of officials of the enemy. 11. Having converted spies, getting hold of the enemy's spies and using them for our own purposes. 12. Having doomed spies, doing certain things openly for purposes of deception and allowing our spies to know of them and report them to the enemy. 13. Surviving spies. Finally, are those who bring back news from the enemy's camp. 14. Hence it is that which none in the whole army are more intimate relations to be maintained than with spies. None should be more liberally rewarded. In no other business should greater secrecy be preserved. 15. Spies cannot be usefully employed without a certain intuitive sagacity. 16. They cannot be properly managed without benevolence and straightforwardness. 17. Without subtle ingenuity of mind, one cannot make certain of the truth of their reports. 18. Be subtle, Be subtle, and use your spies for every kind of business. 19. If a secret piece of news is divulged by a spy before the time is ripe, he must be put to death together with the man to whom the secret was told. 20. Whether the object be to crush an army, to storm a city, or to assassinate an individual, it is always necessary to begin by finding out the names of the attendants, the aides-de-camp, and doorkeepers and sentries of the general in command. Our spies must be commissioned to ascertain these. 21. The enemy's spies who have come to spy on us must be sought out, tempted with bribes, led away, and comfortably housed. Thus they will become converted spies and available for our service. 22. It is through the information brought by the converted spy that we are able to acquire and employ local and inward spies. 23. It is owing to his information, again, that we can cause the doomed spy to carry false tidings to the enemy. 24. Lastly, it is by his information that the surviving spy can be used on appointed occasions. 25. The end and aim of spying in all its five varieties is knowledge of the enemy, and this knowledge can only be derived, in the first instance, from the converted spy. Hence, it is essential that the converted spy be treated with the utmost liberality. 26. Of old, the rise of the Yin dynasty was due to Ai Chi, who had served under the Xie. Likewise, the rise of the Chao dynasty was due to Lu Ya, who had served under the Yin. 27. Hence, it is only the enlightened ruler and the wise general who will use the highest intelligence of the army for purposes of spying, and therefore they achieve great results. Spies are a most important element in war, because on them depends an army's ability to move. The end. Thank you for listening to Sun Tzu on the Art of War by Lionel Giles. Narrated by Kenneth Elliot. Copyright Strelbitsky Multimedia Publishing, 2019.
Lao Tzu, Tao Te Ching. Narrated by Alfred Costa. Part 1. Chapter 1. 1. The Tao that can be trodden is not the enduring and unchanging Tao. The name that can be named is not the enduring and unchanging name. 2. Conceived of as having no name, it is the originator of heaven and earth. Conceived of as having a name, it is the mother of all things. 3. Always without desire, we must be found. If it is deep mystery, we would sound. But if desire always within us be, its outer fringe is all that we shall see. 4. Under these two aspects, it is really the same. But as development takes place, it receives the different names. Together we call them the mystery. Where the mystery is the deepest, is the gate of all that is subtle and wonderful. Chapter 2. 1. All in the world know the beauty of the beautiful, and in doing this, they have an idea of what ugliness is. They all know the skill of the skillful, and in doing this, they have the idea of what the want of skill is. 2. So it is that existence and non-existence give birth the one to the idea of the other. That difficulty and ease produce the one, the idea of the other. That length and shortness fashion out the one, the figure of the other. That the idea of height and lowness arise from the contrast of the one with the other, that the musical notes and tones become harmonious throughout the relationship of one with the other. And that being before and behind gives the idea of following another. 3. Therefore, the sage manages affairs without doing anything, and conveys his instructions without the use of speech. 4. All things spring up, and there is not one which declines to show itself. They grow, and there is no claim made for their ownership. They go through their process, and there is no explanation of a reward for a result. The work is accomplished, and there is no resting in it as an achievement. The work is done, but how no one can see, 'tis this that makes the power not cease to be. Chapter 3. 1. Not to value and employ men of superior ability is the way to keep the people from rivalry amongst themselves. Not to prize articles which are difficult to procure is a way to keep them from becoming thieves. Not to show them what is likely to excite their desires is the way to keep their minds from disorder. 2. Therefore, the sage in this exercise of government empties their minds, fills their bellies, weakens their will, and strengthens their bones. 3. He consistently tries to keep them without knowledge and without desire, and where there are those who have knowledge, to keep them from presuming to act on it. When there is this abstinence from action, good order is universal. Chapter 4. 1. The Tao is like the emptiness of a vessel, and in our employment of it, we must be on guard against all foolishness, how deep and unfathomable it is, as if it were the honored ancestors of all things. 2. We should blunt our sharp points and unravel the complications of things. We should attempt our brightness and bring ourselves into agreement with the obscurity of others. How pure and still the Tao is, as if it were even so continue. 3. I do not know whose son it is. It might appear to have been before God. Chapter 5. 1. Heaven and earth do not act from any impulse of any wish to be benevolent. They deal with all things as the dogs of grass are dealt with. The sage does not act from any wish to be benevolent. They deal with the people as the dogs of grass are dealt with. 2. May not the space between heaven and earth be compared to the bellows? 'Tis emptied, yet it loses not its power. 'Tis moved again, and sends forth air the more. Much speech to swift exhaustion lead we see. Your inner being guard, and keep it free. Chapter 6. The valley spirit dies, not I the same. The female mystery thus do we name. Its gate, from which at first they issued forth, is called the root from which grew heaven and earth. Long and unbroken does its power remain, used gently and without the touch of pain. Chapter 7. 1. Heaven is long enduring, and earth continues long. The reason why heaven and earth are able to endure and continue thus long is because they do not live of or for themselves. This is how they are able to continue and endure. 2. Therefore, the sage puts his own person last, and yet it is found in the foremost place. He treats his person as if it were foreign to him, and yet that person is preserved. It is not because he has no personal or private ends that, therefore, such ends are realized. Chapter 8. 1. The highest excellence is like that of water. The excellence of water appears and is benefiting all things, and is occupying without striving to the contrary. The low place in which all men dislike, hence its ways is near to that of the Tao. 2. The excellence of residence is in the suitability of the place, that of the mind, that the abysmal stillness, that of association is in their being with the virtuous, that of government is in the securing good order, that of the conduct of affairs is in its ability, and that of the initiation of any movement is in its timelessness. 3. And when one with the highest excellence does not wrangle about his low position, no one finds fault with him. Chapter 9. 1. It is better to leave a vessel unfilled than to attempt to carry it when it is full. If you keep feeling a point that has been sharpened, the point cannot long preserve its sharpness. 2. When gold and jade fill the hall, their possessor cannot keep them safe. When wealth and honors lead to arrogancy, this brings its evil on itself. When the work is done and one's name is being distinguished, to withdraw into obscurity is the way of heaven. Chapter 10. 1. When the intelligent and animal souls are held together in one embrace, they can keep from separating. When one gives undivided attention to the vital breath and brings it to the utmost degree of pliancy, he can become as a tender babe. When he has cleansed away the most mysterious sight of his imagination, he can become without a flaw. 2. In loving the people and ruling the state, cannot he proceed without any purpose of action? In the opening and shutting of his gates of heaven, cannot he do so for the female bird? While his intelligence reaches in every direction, cannot he appear to be without knowledge? 3. The Tao produces all things and nourishes them. It produces them and does not claim them as its own. It does all, and yet does not boast about it. It presides over all, and yet does not control them. This is what is called the mysterious quality of the Tao. Chapter 11. The 30 spokes unite in the one nave, but is the empty space for the axle. That is the use of the wheel depends. Clay is fashioned into vessels, but it is their empty hollowness that their use depends. The doors and windows are cut from the walls to form an apartment, but it is the empty space within that its use depends. Therefore, what has a positive existence served for profitable adaptation, and what has not that for actual usefulness? Chapter 12. 1. Colors five hues, for the eyes their sight will take. Music's five notes, the ears as deaf can make. The flavors five deprive the mouth of taste, the chariot's course, and the wild hunter's waste. Make mad the mind, and the objects rare and strange, sought for, men's conduct will to evil change. 2. Therefore, the sage seeks to satisfy the cravings of the belly, and not the insatiable longing of the eyes. He puts for him the latter, and prefers to seek the former. Chapter 13. 1. Favor and disgrace would seem equally to be feared. Honor the great calamity to be regarded as personal conditions of the same kind. 2. What is meant by speaking thus of favor and disgrace? Disgrace is being in a low position after the enjoyment of favor. The getting that favor leads to the apprehension of losing it, and the losing it leads to the fear of still greater calamity. This is what is meant by saying that favor and disgrace will seem equally to be feared. And what is meant by saying honor and great calamity are to be similar, regarded as personal conditions? What makes me liable to great calamity is my having the body which I call myself. If I had not the body, what great calamity could come of me? 3. Therefore, he would administer the kingdom, honoring it as he honors his own person, may be employed to govern it, and he who would administer it with the love which he bears to his own person may be entrusted with it. Chapter 14. 1. We look at it and we do not see it, and we name it the equable. We listen to it and we do not hear it, and we name it the inaudible. We try to grasp it and do not get hold of it, and we name it the subtle. With these three qualities, it cannot be made the subject of descriptions, and hence we blend them together to obtain the one. 2. Its upper part is not bright, and its lower part is not obscure. Ceaseless in its actions, it yet cannot be named, and then it again returns to become nothing. This is called the form of the formless, and the semblance of the invisible. This is called the fleeting of the indeterminable. 3. We meet it and do not see its front. We follow it and do not see its back. When you can lay hold of the Tao of the old to direct the things of the present day and are able to know it as it was of old in the beginning, this is called unwinding the clue of Tao. Chapter 15. 1. The skillful master of the Tao in old times, with a subtle and exquisite penetration, comprehended its mysteries and were deep also to indulge men's knowledge. As they were thus beyond men's knowledge, I will make the effort to describe of what sort they appear to be. 2. Shrinking looked, they look like those whose wade through a stream in winter, irresolute like those who are afraid of all around them, grave like a guest, in awe of its host, evanescent like ice that is melting away, unpretentious like wood that has not been fashioned into anything, vacant like the valley, and dull like muddy water. 3. Who can make the muddy waters clear? Let it be still, and it will gradually become clear. Who can secure the conditions of rest? Let movement go on, and the conditions of rest will gradually arise. 4. They who preserve this method of the Tao do not wish to be full of themselves. It is through their not being full of themselves that they can afford to seem worn and not appear new and complete. Chapter 16. 1. The state of vacancy should be brought to the utmost degree, and that of the stillness guarded with the unwary vigor. All things alike go through their process of activity, and then we see them return to the original state. When things in the vegetable world have displayed their luxuriant growth, they see each of them return to the roots. This return to the roots is what we call the state of stillness. And that stillness may be called a reporting that they have fulfilled their appointed end. 2. The report of fulfillment is the regular unchanging rule. To know the unchanging rule is to be intelligent. Not to know it leads to wild movement and evil issues. The knowledge of the unchanging rule produces a grand capacity and forbearance. And that capacity and forbearance leads to a community of feeling with all things. From this community, the feeling comes of kindness of character. And he who is kind-like goes on to be heaven-like. In that likeness of heaven, he possesses the Tao. Possessing the Tao, he endures long, and to the end of his body life, is exempt from all dangers of decay. Chapter 17. 1. In the highest antiquity, the people did not know that there were their rules. In the next age, they loved them and praised them. In the next, they feared them. In the next, they despised them. Thus, in that way, when faith in the Tao was deficient in the rules and want of faith and them ensured in the people. 2. How, Israelute, did those earliest rulers appear? Showing, by their retense, the importance which they set upon their words. Their work was done, and their undertakings were successful, while the people all said, "We are as we are, ourselves." Chapter 18. 1. When the great Tao, way or method, ceased to be observed, benevolence and righteousness came into vogue. Then appeared wisdom and shrewdness, and there ensured great hypocrisy. 2. When harmony no longer prevailed throughout the six kinships, Filian sons found their manifestations when states and clans fell into disorder. Loyal ministers appeared. Chapter 19. 1. If we could renounce our sadness and discard our wisdom, it would be better for the people 100-fold. If we could renounce our benevolence and discard our righteousness, the people would again become filia and kindly. If we could renounce our artfulness, contrivance, and discard our scheming for gain, there would be no thieves nor robbers. 2. Those three methods of government thought olden ways in elegance did fail, and made these names their want and worth to veil. But simple views and course plain and true with selfish ends and money lusts askew. Chapter 20. 1. When we renounce learning, we have no troubles. The ready yes and the flattering yea, small is the difference they display. But mark their issues, good and ill, what space the gulf between shall fill. What all men fear is indeed to be feared. But how wide and without end is the range of questions, asking to be discussed. 2. The multitude of men look satisfied and pleased, as if enjoying a full banquet, as if mounted on a tower in spring. I alone seem listless and still, my desires having as yet given no indication of their presence. I am like an infant who has not yet smiled. I look dejected and foreign, as if I had no home to go to. The multitude of men all have enough and to spare. I alone seem to have lost everything. My mind is that of a stupid man. I am in the state of chaos. Ordinary men look bright and intelligent, while I alone seem to be benighted. They look full of discrimination, while I alone am dull and confused. I seem to be carried about as on the sea, drifting as if I had nowhere to rest. All men have their spheres of action, while I alone seem dull and incapable, like a rude boarder. Thus, I alone am different from other men, but I value nursing mother, the Tao. Chapter 21. The grandest form of activity force, from Tao come their only source. Who can of Tao the nature tell? Our sight it flies, our touch as well. Indulging sight, indulging touch, the form of things all in it crouch. Indulging touch, indulging sight, there are the semblance all right. profound it is, dark and obscure, things essence, all there endure. Those essence, the truth enfold, of what, when seen, shall then be told. Now is it so, 'twas so of old, its name, what pass, not away, so in their beautiful array. Things form and never know decay. How know I it is so with all the beautiful and existing things? By this, the nature of the Tao. Chapter 22. 1. The partial becomes complete. The crooked straight, the empty full, and the worn out new. He whose desires are few gets them. He whose desires are many goes astray. 2. Therefore, the sage holds in his embrace the one thing of humility and manifests it to all the world. He is free of self-display, and therefore he shines, from self-assertion, and therefore he is distinguished, from self-boasting, and therefore his merits is acknowledged, from self-compliance, and therefore he acquires superiority. It is because he is thus free from striving, and therefore no one in the world is able to strive with him. 3. That saying of ancients that the partial becomes complete was not vainly spoken. All real completion is comprehended under it. Chapter 23. 1. Upstanding from speech marks him who is obeying the spontaneity of his nature. A violent wind does not last for the whole morning. A sudden rain does not last for the whole day. To whom is it that these two things are owing? To heaven and earth. If heaven and earth cannot make such actings last long, how much less can man? 2. Therefore, when one is making the Tao his business, those who are also pursuing it agree with him in it, and those who are making the manifestation of its course their object agree with him in that, while even those who are failing in both of these agree with him where they fail. 3. Hence, those with whom he agrees as to the Tao have the happiness of attaining to it. Those with whom he agrees as to its manifestation have the happiness of attaining to it, and those to whom he agrees in their failure have also the happiness of attaining to the Tao. But when there is no faith sufficient on his part, and want of faith in him ensures on the part of the other. Chapter 24. He who stands on his tiptoes does not stand firm. He who stretches his legs does not walk easily. So he who displays himself does not shine. He who asserts his own views is not distinguished. He who vaunts himself does not find his merit acknowledged. He who is self-conceited has no superiority allowed to him. Such conditions, viewed from the standpoint of the Tao, are like remnants of food or a tumor on a body, which all dislike. Hence, those who pursue the course of the Tao do not adopt and allow them. Chapter 25. 1. There was something undefined and complete, coming into existence before heaven and earth. How still it was a formless, standing alone, and undergoing no change, reaching everywhere and in no danger of being exhausted. It may be regarded as the mother of all things. 2. I don't know its name, and I give it the designation of the Tao, the way or course. Making an effort further to give it a name, I call it the Great. 3. Great. It passes on in consistent flow. Passing on, it becomes remote. Having become remote, it returns. Therefore, the Tao is great. Heaven is great. Earth is great. And the sage, king, is also great. In the universe, there are four that are great. and the sage, king, is one of them. 4. Man takes his law from the earth takes its law from the heavens, heavens takes its law from the Tao. The law of the Tao is its being what it is. Chapter 26. 1. Gravity is the root of lightness, stillness the ruler of movement. 2. Therefore, a wise prince, marching the whole day, does not go far from his baggage wagon. Although he may have brilliant prospects to look at, he quietly remains in his proper place. Indifferent to them, how should the lord of the mirrored chariot carry himself lightly before the kingdom? If he do act lightly, he has lost his roots, or gravity. If he proceeds to active movement, he will lose his throne. Chapter 27. 1. The skillful traveler leaves no trace of his wheels or footsteps. The skillful speaker says nothing that can be found fault with or blame. The skillful reckoner uses no tallies. The skillful closer needs no bolts or bars. While to open what he has shut will be impossible, the skillful binder uses no strings or knots. While to unloose what he has bound will be impossible, in the same way the sage is always skillful at saving men, and so he does not cast away any men. He is always skillful at saving things, and so he does not cast away anything. This is called hiding the light of his procedure. 2. Therefore, the man of skill is the master, to be looked up to, by him who has not the skill. And he who is not the skill is the helper of the reputation of him who has skill. If the one did not honor his master, and the other did not rejoice in his helper, through intelligence might greatly err about them. This is called the utmost degree of mystery. Chapter 28. 1. He who knows his manhood's strengths, yet still his female feebleness maintains, as to one channel flow the many drains, all come to him, ye all beneath the sky. Thus he the constant excellence retains, the simple child again, free from all stains. Who knows how white attracts, yet always keeps himself within black shades? The pattern of humility displayed in view of all beneath the sky. He is the unchanging excellence array, endless return to man's first state has made. You know how glory shines, yet love disgrace, nor err from it is pale. Behold his presence in a spacious veil, to which men come from all beneath the sky. The unchanging excellence completes its tale. The simple infant man is well we hail. 2. The unwrought material we divided and distributed forms vessels. The sage, when employed, becomes the head of the office or government, and in his greatest regulations he employs no violent measures. Chapter 29. 1. If anyone should wish to get the kingdom for himself, and to effect this by what he does, I see he will not succeed. The kingdom is a spirit-like thing, and cannot be got by active doing. He who would so win it destroys it. He who would hold it in its grasp loses it. 2. The course of nature of things is such that what was in front is now behind. What warmed anon we freezing find. Strength is of weakness, oft the spoil. The store in ruins mocks our toil. Hence, the sage puts away excessive effort, extravagance, and easy indulgence. Chapter 30. 1. He who would assist a lord of men in harmony with the Tao will not assert his mastery in the kingdom by force of arms. Such a course is sure to meet with its proper return. 2. Whenever a host is stationary, briars and thorns spring up. In the sequence of great armies, there are sure to be bad years. 3. A skillful commander strikes a decisive blow and stops. He does not dare, by continuing his operation, to assert and complete his mastery. He will strike the blow, but will be on his guard against being vain or boastful or arrogant in conquest of it. He strikes it as a matter of necessity. He strikes it, but not from the wish of mastery. 4. When things have attained their strong maturity, they become old. This may be said to be not in accordance with the Tao, and what is not in accordance with it soon comes to an end. Chapter 31. 1. Now arms, however beautiful, are instruments of evil omen, hateful, it may be said, to all creatures. Therefore, they who have the Tao do not like to employ them. 2. The superior man ordinarily considers the left hand the most honorable place, but in times of war, the right hand, those sharp weapons, are instruments of evil omen, and not the instruments of the superior man. He uses them only on the compulsion of necessity. Calm and response are the prizes. Victory, by force of arms, is to him undesirable. To consider this desirable would be to delight in the slaughter of men, and he who delights in the slaughter of men cannot get his will in the kingdom. 3. On occasion of festivity, to be on the left hand is the prize position. On occasion of the mourning, the right hand, the second in command of the army, has his place on the left. The general commander-in-chief has his on the right. His place, that is assigned to him as a rite of mourning. He who has killed multitudes of men should weep for them with the bitterness grief, and the victor in battle has his place, rightly according to those rites. Chapter 32. 1. The Tao, considered as unchanging, has no name. 2. Though it is primordial simplicity, it may be small. The whole world dares not to deal with one embodying it as a minister. If a feudal prince or king could guard and hold it, all would be spontaneously submit themselves to him. 3. Heaven and earth, under its guidance, unite together and send down the sweet dew, which, without the direction of men, reaches equally everywhere as if its own accord. 4. As soon as it proceeds to action, it has a name. When it once has that name, men can know to rest in it. When they know to rest in it, they can be free from all risk of failure and error. 5. The relationship of the Tao to the world is like that of the great river and seas to the streams from the valleys. Chapter 33. 1. He who knows other men is discerning. He who knows himself is intelligent. He who overcomes others is strong. He who overcomes himself is mighty. He who is satisfied with his lot is rich. He who goes on acting with energy has a firm will. 2. He who does not fail in the requirement of his position continues long. He who dies and yet does not perish has longevity. Chapter 34. 1. All-pervading is the great Tao. It may be found on the left hand and on the right. 2. All things depend on it for their production, which it gives to them, not one refusing obedience to it. When its work is accomplished, it does not claim the name of having done it. It clothes all things as with a garment, and makes no assumptions of being their lord. It may be named in the smallest things. All things return to their roots and disappear, and do not know that it is which presides over their doing so. It may be named in the greatest things. 3. Hence, the sage is able, in the same way, to accomplish his great achievements. It is through his not making himself great that he can accomplish them. Chapter 35. 1. To him who holds his hands the great image of the invisible Tao, the whole world repairs. Men resort to him and receive no hurt, but find rest, peace, and the feeling of ease. 2. Music and dainties with make the passing guest stop for a time, but though the Tao comes from the mouth, seems insipid and has no flavor, though it seems not worth being looked at or listened to, the use of it is inexhaustible. Chapter 36. 1. When one is about to take an inspiration, he is sure to make a previous expiration. When he is going to weaken another, he will first strengthen him. When he is going to overthrow another, he will first have raised him up. When he is going to despoil another, he will first have made gifts to him. This is called hiding the light of his procedure. 2. The soft overcomes the hard, and the weak the strong. 3. Fishes should not be taken from the deep. Instruments for the profit of the state should not be shown to the people. Chapter 37. 1. The Tao in its regular course does nothing for the sake of doing it, and so there is nothing which it does not do. 2. If princes and kings were able to maintain it, all things would of themselves be transformed by them. 3. If this transformation became to me an object of desire, I would express the desire by the nameless simplicity. Simplicity without a name is free from all external aim. With no desire, at rest and still, all things go right as of their will. Part 2, Chapter 38. 1. Those who possess the highest degree the attributes of the Tao do not seek to show them, and therefore they possess them in the fullest measure. Those who possess in a lower degree those attributes sought how not to lose them, and therefore they did not possess them in the fullest measure. 2. Those who possessed in the highest degree those attributes did nothing with a purpose and had no need to do anything. Those who possessed those in the lowest degree were always doing and had need to be so doing. 3. Those who possessed the highest benevolence were always seeking to carry out and had no need to be doing so. Those who possessed the highest righteousness were always seeking to carry it out and had no need to be so doing. 4. Those who possessed the highest sense of priority were always seeking to show it, and when men did not respond to it, they bare the arms and marched up to them. 5. Thus it was that when the Tao was lost, its attributes appeared. When its attributes were lost, benevolence appeared. When benevolence was lost, righteousness appeared. And when righteousness was lost, the properties appeared. 6. Now priority is the attenuated form of the lead-heartedness and good faith, and is also the commencement of the disorder. Swift apprehension is only a flower of the Tao and is beginning of stupidity. 7. Thus it is that the great main abides by what is solid and askew what is flimsy, dwells with the fruit and not with the flower. It is thus that it puts away the one to make choice of the other. Chapter 39. 1. The things which from the old have got the one, the Tao, are heaven, which by it is bright and pure, earth rendered thereby firm and sure, spirits with powers by it supplied, valleys kept full throughout their void, all creatures which through it do live, prince and kings who from it get the model which to all they give. 2. All these are the results of the one, Tao. If heaven were not thus pure, it soon would rend. If earth were not thus sure, 'twould break and bend. Without these powers, the spirit soon would fail. If not so filled, the drought would parch each vale. Without that life, creatures would pass away, prince and kings without the moral sway, however grand and high, would all decay. 3. Thus it is that dignity finds itself firm root in its previous meanness, and what is lofty finds its stability in the lowness from which it rises. Hence prince and kings call themselves orphans, men of small virtue, and as carriages without a nave, and not in this acknowledgment that in their consider themselves mean they see the foundation of their dignity, so in this that in the enumeration of the different parts of the carriage we do not come on what makes it answer the end of the carriage, they do not wish to show themselves elegant looking as jade, but prefer to be coarse looking as an ordinary stone. Chapter 40. 1. The movement of the Tao by contrary proceeds, and weakness marks the course of the Tao's mighty deeds. 2. All things under heaven sprang from it as existing and named. That existence sprang from it as non-existent and not named. Chapter 41. 1. Scholars of the highest class, when they hear about the Tao, earnestly carry it into practice. Scholars of the middle class, when they hear about it, seem now to keep it and now to lose it. Scholars of the lowest class, when they have heard about it, laugh greatly at it. If it were not thus laughed at, it would not be fit to be the Tao. 2. Therefore, the sentence makers have thus expressed themselves. The Tao, when brightest seen, seems light to lack, whose progress in it makes seems drawing back, is even way, is like the rugged track, is highest virtue from the value does rise, is greatest beauty seems to offend the eyes, and he has most whose lot the least supplies. Its firmness, virtue seem but poor and low. Its solid truth seems changed to undergo. Its largest square doth yet no corner show. A vessel great, it is the slowest made. Loud is its sound, but never word is said. A semblance great, a shadow of the shade. 3. The Tao is hidden and has no name, but it is the Tao which is skillful and imparting to all things what they need, and making them complete. Chapter 42. 1. The Tao produced 1, 1 produced 2, 2 produced 3, 3 produced all things. All things leave behind them the obscurity out of which they have come, and go forward to embrace the brightness into which they have emerged, while they are harmonious by the breath of vacancy. 2. What men dislike is to be orphans, to have little virtue, to be as carriages without knaves, and yet these are the designations which kings and princes use for themselves. So it is that some things are increased by being diminished, and others are diminished by being increased. 3. What other men thus teach, I also teach. The violent and strong do not die their natural death. I will make this the basis of my teaching. Chapter 43. 1. The softest things in the world dashes against and overcomes the hardest. That which has no substantial existence enters where there is no crevice. I know hereby that advantage belongs to doing nothing with a purpose. 2. There are few in the world who attain to the teaching without words, and the advantage arising from non-action. Chapter 44. 1. Or fame or life, which do you hold more dear? Or life or wealth, to which would you adhere? Keep life and lose those other things. Keep them and lose your life, which brings sorrow and pain more near? 2. Thus we may see, whose cleaves to fame, rejects what is more great, who loves large stores, gives up the richer state. 3. Who is content, needs fear no shame, who knows to stop, incurs no blame, from danger free, long live shall he. Chapter 45. 1. Who thinks his great achievement poor, shall find his vigor long endure, of greatest fullness deemed a void, exhaustion near shall steam the tide. Do thou what straight still crooked deemed, thy greatest art still stupid seem, and eloquence a stammering scream. 2. Constant action overcomes cold, being still overcomes heat. Purity and stillness give the correct law to all under heaven. Chapter 46. 1. When the Tao prevails in the world, they send back their swift horses to draw the dung carts. When the Tao is disregarded in the world, the war horses breed in the borderlands. 2. There is no guilt greater than to sanction ambition, no calamity greater than to be discontented with one's lot, no fault greater than the wish to be getting. Therefore, the sufficiency of the contentment is an enduring and unchanging sufficiency. Chapter 47. 1. Without going outside his door, one understands all that takes place under the sky. Without looking out from his window, one sees the Tao of heaven. The farther that one goes out for himself, the less he knows. 2. Therefore, the sages got their knowledge without traveling, gave their right names to things without seeing them, and accomplished their ends without any purpose of doing so. Chapter 48. 1. He who devotes himself to learning seeks from day to day to increase his knowledge. He who devotes himself to the Tao seeks from day to day to diminish his doing. 2. He diminishes it and again diminishes it, till he arrives at doing nothing on purpose. Having arrived at this point of non-action, there is nothing which he does not do. 3. He who gets as his own all under heaven does so by giving himself no trouble with that end. If one take trouble with that end, he is not equal to getting as his own all under heaven. Chapter 49. 1. The sage has no invariable mind of his own. He makes the mind of the people his mind. 2. To those who are good to me, I am good, and to those who are not good to me, I am also good, and thus all get to be good. To those who are sincere with me, I am sincere. To those who are not sincere with me, I am also sincere, and thus all get to be sincere. 3. The sage has in the world an appearance of indecision, and keeps his mind in the state of indifference to all. The people all keep their eyes and ears direct to him, and he deals with them all as his children. Chapter 50. 1. Men come forth and live, they enter again and die. 2. Of every 10, 3 are ministers of life to themselves, and 3 are ministers of death. 3. There are also 3 in every 10 whose aim is to live, but whose movement tends to the land, or place, of death. And for what reason? Because of their excessive endeavors to perpetuate life. 4. But I have heard that he who is skillful in managing the life entrusted to him, for a time will travel on the land, without having to shun rhinoceros or tigers, and enter a host without having to avoid buff coat or sharp weapons. The rhinoceros finds no place in him into which to thrust his horn, nor the tiger a place in which to fix its claws, nor the weapon a place to emit its point. And for what reason? Because there is in him no place of death. Chapter 51. 1. All things are produced by the Tao and nourished by its outflowing operations. They receive their forms according to the nature of each and are complete according to the circumstance of their conditions. Therefore, all things without exception honor the Tao and exalt its outflowing operations. 2. This honoring of the Tao and exalting of its operations is not the result of any ordination, but always a spontaneous tribute. 3. Thus it is that the Tao produces all things, nourishes them, brings them to their full growth, nurses them, completes them, matures them, maintains them, and overspreads them. 4. It produces them and makes no claim to the possession of them. It carries them through their process and does not vault its ability in doing so. It brings them to maturity and exercises no control over them. This is called its mysterious operations. Chapter 52. 1. The Tao which originated all under the sky is to be considered as the mother of them all. 2. When the mother is found, we know that her children should be. When one knows that he is his mother's child and proceeds to guard the qualities of the mother that belongs to him, to the end of his life, he will be free from all peril. 3. Let him keep his mouth closed and shut up his portals of his nostrils, and all his life he will be exempt from laborious exertion. Let him keep his mouth open and spend his breath in promotion of his affairs, and all his life there will be no safety for him. 4. The perception of what is small is the secret of clear-sightedness. The guarding of what is soft and tender is the secret of strength. 5. Who uses well his light, reverting to its source so bright, will from his body ward all blight and hide the unchanging from men's sight. Chapter 53. 1. If I were suddenly to become known and put into a position to conduct a government, according to the great Tao, what I should be most afraid of would be boastful display. 2. The great Tao, or way, is very level and easy, but people love the byways. 3. Their courtyards and buildings shall be well kept, but their fields shall be ill cultivated, and their granaries very empty. They shall wear elegant and ornamental robes, carry a sharp sword on their girdle, pamper themselves in eating and drinking, and have a superabundance of property and wealth. Such princes may be called robbers and boasters. This is contrary to the Tao, surely. Chapter 54. 1. What Tao's skillful planter plants can never be uptorn. What his skillful arms enfold from him can ne'er be born. Sons shall bring in lengthened line sacrifices to his shrine. 2. Tao, when nursed within oneself, his vigor will make true, and where the family it rules. What riches will occur, the neighborhood where it prevails, and thriving will abound, and when 'tis seen throughout the state. Good fortune will be found, employ it the kingdom o'er, and men thrive all around. 3. This is the way the effect will be seen in person by the observation of different cases, in the family, in the neighborhood, in the state, and in the kingdom. 4. How do you know that this effect is sure to hold thus all under the sky? By this method of observation. Chapter 55. 1. He who has in himself abundantly the attributes of the Tao is like an infant. Poisonous insects will not sting him. Fierce beasts will not seize him. Birds of prey will not strike him. 2. The infant's bones are weak and his sinew soft, but yet it grasps its firm. I know not yet the union of male and female, and yet the virile members may be excited, showing the perfection of its physical essence, all day long it will cry without its throat becoming hoarse, showing the harmony in its constitution. 3. To him by whom his harmony is known, the secret of the unchanging Tao is shown, and in the knowledge wisdom finds its throne, all life increasing art to evil turn, where the mind makes the vital breath to burn, false is strength, and o'er it we should mourn. 4. When things have become strong, they then become old, which may be said to the contrary to the Tao. Whatever is contrary to the Tao soon ends. Chapter 56. 1. He who knows the Tao does not care to speak about it. He who is ever ready to speak about it does not know it. 2. He who knows it will keep his mouth shut and close the portals of his nostrils. He will blunt his sharp point and unravel the complications of things. He will attempt his brightness to bring himself into agreement with the obscurity of others. This is called the mysterious agreement. 3. Such as one cannot be treated familiarly or distantly, he is beyond all consideration of profit or injury, of notability or meanness. He is the noblest man under heaven. Chapter 57. 1. A state may be ruled by measure of correction. Weapons of war may be used with crafty dexterity, but the kingdom is made one's own only by the freedom of action and purpose. 2. How do I know that it is so? By these facts. In the kingdom, the multiplication of prohibitive enactments increases the poverty of the people. The more implements to add to their profit that the people have, the greater discorder is there in the state and clan. The more acts and crafty dexterity that men possesses, the more do strange conveyances appear. The more display there in the legislation, the more thieves and robbers there are. 3. Therefore the sage has said, I will do nothing of purpose, and the people will be transformed of themselves. I will be found of keeping still, and the people of themselves become correct. I will take no trouble about it, and the people will of themselves become rich. I will manifest no ambition, and the people will of themselves attain to the primitive simplicity. Chapter 58. 1. The government that seems the most unwise, oft goodness to the people best supplies. That which is melding, touching everything, will work but ill and disappointment bring. Misery, happiness is to be found by its side. Happiness, misery lurks beneath it. Who knows what either will come to in the end? 2. Shall we then dispense with corrections? The method of corrections shall by a turn become distortions, and the good in it shall by a turn become evil. The delusion of the people on this point has indeed subsided for a long time. 3. Therefore, the sage is like a square which cuts no one with its angles, like a corner which injures no one with its sharpness. He is straightforward, but allows himself no license. He is bright, but he does not dazzle. Chapter 59. 1. For regulations, the human, in our constitution, and the rendering the proper service to the heavenly, there is nothing like moderation. 2. It is only by this moderation that there is an effective and early return to man's normal state. That early return is what I call the repeated accumulation of the attribute of the Tao. With this repeated accumulation of those attributes, there comes the subjugation of the obstacle to such return. Of this subjugation, we know not what shall be the limit, and when one knows not what the limit shall be, he may be the ruler of the state. 3. He who possesses the mother of the state may continue long. His case is like that of a plant, of which we say that its roots are deep and the flower stalk is firm. This is the way to secure that its enduring life shall long be seen. Chapter 60. 1. Governing a great state is like cooking small fish. 2. Let the kingdom be governed according to the Tao, and the maims of the departed will not manifest their spiritual energy. It is not that those maims have not the spiritual energy, but it will not be employed to hurt men. It is not that it could not hurt men, but neither does the ruling sage hurt them. 3. When these two do not injuriously affect each other, the good influences converge in the virtue of the Tao. Chapter 61. 1. What makes a great state is that its being like a low-lying, downflowing stream. It becomes the century to which tends all the small states under heaven. 2. To illustrate from the case of all females, the females always overcome the males by their stillness. Stillness may be considered a sort of abasement. 3. Thus it is the great state, by condescending to small states, gains them for itself, and that the small states, by abasing themselves to the great state, win it over to them. In the one case, the abasement leads to gaining adherent, in the other case, to procuring favor. 4. The great state only wishes to unite men together and nourish them. The small state only wishes to receive by and serve the other. Each gets what it desires, but the great state must learn to abase itself. Chapter 62. 1. Tao has of all things the most honored place. No treasure gives good men so rich and grace. Bad men it guards, and dot their ill of face. 2. Its admirable words can purchase honor. Its admirable deeds can raise their performance above others. Each men who are not good are not abandoned by it. 3. Therefore, when the sovereign occupies his place as the son of heaven, and he has appointed his 3 ducal ministers, though a prince were to send a round symbol of rank large enough to fill both hands, and that as the precursor of the team of horses in the courtyard, such an offering would not be equal to a lesson of this Tao, which one might present on his knees. 4. Why was it that the ancients prized this Tao so much? Was it not because it could be got by seeking for it, and the guilty could escape from the stain of their guilt by it? This is the reason why all under heaven consider it the most valuable thing. Chapter 63. 1. It is the way of the Tao to act without thinking of acting, to conduct affairs without feeling the trouble of them, to taste without discerning any flavor, to consider what is small as great, and few as many, and to the recompense injury with kindness. 2. The mastery of it anticipates things that are difficult while they are easy, and does things that would become great while they are small. All difficult things in the world are sure to arise from a previous state in which they were easy, and all great things from one in which they were small. Therefore, the sage, while he never does what is great, is able on that account to accomplish the greatest things. 3. He who lightly promises is sure to keep but little faith. He who is continually thinking things easy is sure to find them difficult. Therefore, the sage sees difficulty even in what seems easy, and so never has any difficulties. Chapter 64. 1. That which is at rest is easy kept hold of. Before a thing is given indications of its presence, it is easy to take measure against it. That which is brittle is easily broken. That which is very small is easily dispensed. Action should be taken before a thing has made its appearance. Order should be secured before disorder has begun. 2. The tree which fills the arms grew from the tiniest sprout. The tower of 9 stories rose from the smallest heap of earth. The journey of 1,000 li commenced with a single step. 3. He who acts with the ulterior purpose does harm. He who takes hold of things in the same way loses his hold. The sage does not act so, and therefore does no harm. He does not lay hold so, and therefore does not lose his hold. But people and their conduct of affairs are constantly ruining them when they are on the eve of success. If they were careful at the end, as they should be, at the beginning, they would not ruin them. 4. Therefore, the sage desires what other men do not desire, and does not prize things difficult to get. He learns what other men do not learn, and turns back to the multitude of men have passed by. Thus, he helps the natural development of things, and does not dare to act with the ulterior purpose of his own. Chapter 65. 1. The ancients who showed their skill in practicing the Tao did so, not to enlighten the people, but rather to make them simple and ignorant. 2. The difficulty in governing the people arises from their having much knowledge. He who tries to govern a state by his wisdom is a scourge to it, while he who does not try to do so is a blessing. 3. He who knows these two things finds in them also his model and rule. Ability to know his model and rule constitutes what we call the mysterious excellence of the governor. Deep and far-reaching is such mystery excellence, showing indeed its possessor and opposite to each other, but leading them to the great conformity to him. Chapter 66. 1. That whereby the rivers and seas are able to receive the homage and tributes of the valley streams is their skill in being lower than they. It is thus that they are the kings of them all. So it is that the sage ruler wishes to be above men, puts himself by his words below them, and wishes to be before them, places his person behind them. 2. In this way, he has his place above them, men do not feel his weight, nor, though he has his place before them, do they feel it an injury to them. 3. Therefore, all in the world delight to exalt him, and do not weary of him, because he does not strive, no one finds it possible to strive with him. Chapter 67. 1. All the world says that, while my Tao is great, it yet appears to be inferior to other systems of teaching. Now, it is just its greatness that makes it seem to be inferior. If it were like other systems, for long would its smallness have been known. 2. But I have 3 precious things which I prize and hold fast. The first is gentleness, the second is economy, and the third is the shrinking from taking precedence of others. 3. With that gentleness, I can be bold. With that economy, I can be liberal. Shrinking from taking precedence of others, I can become a vessel of the highest honor. Nowadays, they give up gentleness and are all for being bold, economy, and are all for being liberal. The hindmost place, and seeks only to be the foremost, of all which the end is, death. 4. Gentleness is sure to be victorious even in battle, and firmly to maintain its ground. Heaven will save its possessors by his very gentleness protecting him. Chapter 68. He who in Tao's wars has skill assumes no material port. He who fights with most goodwill to range makes no resort. He who vanishes yet still keeps from his foes apart. He who has men most fulfill yet humble plies his art. Thus we say he's near contend, and therein is his might. Thus we say men's will he bends, that they will him unite. Thus we say like heavens his ends, no sage of old more bright. Chapter 69. 1. A master of the art of war has said, I do not dare to be the host to commence the war. I prefer to be the guest to act on the defense. I do not dare to advance an inch. I prefer to retire a foot. This is called marshaling the ranks where there are no ranks, bearing the arms to fight where there are no arms to bear, grasping the weapon where there is no weapon to grasp, advancing against the enemy where there is no enemy. 2. There is no calamity greater than lightly engaging in war. To do that is near losing the gentleness which is so precious. Thus it is when opposing weapons are actually crossed, he who deplores the situation conquers. Chapter 70. 1. My words are very easy to know and very easy to practice, but there is no one in the world who is able to know and able to practice them. 2. There is an originating and all-comprehending principle in my words, and an authoritative law for those things which I enforce. It is because they do not know these that men do not know me. 3. They who know me are few, and I am on that account the more to be prized. It is such that the sage wears a poor garb of hair cloth while he carries his signet of jade in his bosom. Chapter 71. 1. To know and yet think we do not know is the highest attainment. Not to know and yet think we do know is a disease. 2. It is simply by being pained at the thought of having this disease that we are preserved from it. The sage has not the disease. He knows the pain and he would be inseparable from it, and therefore he does not have it. Chapter 72. 1. When the people do not fear what they ought to fear, that which is their great dread will come on them. 2. Let them not thoughtlessly indulge themselves in the ordinary life. Let that not act as wary of what that life depends on. 3. It is by avoiding such indulgences that such wariness does not arise. 4. Therefore, the sage knows these things of himself, but does not parade his knowledge, loves, but does not appear to set a value on himself, and thus puts the latter alternative away and makes choice of the former. Chapter 73. 1. He whose boldness appears in his daring to do wrong in defiance of the law is put to death. He whose boldness appears in his not daring to do so lives on. Of these two cases, the one appears to be adventurous and the other to be injurious. But when heaven's anger smites a man, whose cause shall truly scan? On this account, the sage feels a difficulty as what to do in the former case. 2. It is the way of heaven not to strive, and yet it is skillful in obtaining a reply. Does not call, and yet men come to it of themselves. Its demonstrations are quiet, and yet its plans are skillful and effective. The meshes of the net of heaven are large, far apart, but letting nothing escape. Chapter 74. 1. The people do not fear death. To what purpose is it to try to frighten them with death? If the people were always in awe of death, and I could always seize them who do wrong and put them to death, who would dare to do wrong? 2. There is always one who presides over the infliction of death. He who would inflict death in a room of him who so proceeds over it may be described as hewing wood instead of a great carpenter. Seldom is it that he who undertakes the hewing instead of the great carpenter does not cut his own hands. Chapter 75. 1. The people suffer from famine because of the multitude of taxes consumed by their superiors. It is through that they suffer famine. 2. The people are difficult to govern because of the excessive agencies of their superiors in governing them. It is through this that they are difficult to govern. 3. The people make light of dying because of the greatness of their labors in seeking for means of living. It is this which makes them think light of dying. Thus, it is that to leave the subject of living altogether out of view is better than to set high value on it. Chapter 76. 1. Man at his birth is supple and weak, at his death, firm and strong. So it is with all things. Trees and plants, in their early growth, are soft and brittle, and at their death, dry and withered. 2. Thus it is the firmness and strength are the concomitants of death, softness and weakness the concomitants of life. 3. Hence he who relies on the strength of his forces does not conquer, and a tree which is strong will fill the outstretched arms, and thereby invites the feller. 4. Therefore, the place of what is firm and strong is below, and that of what is soft and weak is above. Chapter 77. 1. May not the way or tau of heaven be compared to the method of bending a bow? The part of the bow which is high is brought low, and what is low is raised up. So heaven diminishes where there is a superabundance and supplements where there is a deficiency. 2. It is the way of heaven to diminish superabundance and to supplement deficiency. It is not so with the way of man. He takes away from those who have not enough to add to his own superabundance. 3. Who can take his own superabundance and therewith serve all under heaven? Only he who is in possession of the Tao. 4. Therefore, the ruling sage acts without claiming the results as his. He achieves his merit and does not rest arrogantly in it. He does not wish to display his superiority. Chapter 78. 1. There is nothing in the world more soft and weak than water. And yet for attacking things that are firm and strong, there is nothing that can take precedence of it. There is nothing so effectual for which it can be changed. 2. Everyone in the world knows that the soft overcomes the hard and the weak the strong, but no one is able to carry it out in practice. 3. Therefore, a sage has said, he who accepts his state's reproach is hailed therefore to alter Lord. To him who bears men's direful woes, they are all named of King Accord. 4. The words that are strictly true seem to be paradoxical. Chapter 79. 1. When a reconciliation is effected between two parties, after a great amnesty, there is sure to be a grudge retaining in the mind of the one who was wrong. And how can this be beneficial to the other? 2. Therefore, to guard against this, the sage keeps his left-hand position of record of the engagement and does not insist on the speedy fulfillment of it by the other party. So, he who has the attributes of the Tao regards only the conditions of the engagement, while he who has those attributes regards only the conditions favorable to himself. 3. In the way of heaven, there is no partiality of love. It is always on the side of the good man. Chapter 80. 1. In a little state with a small population, I would so order it that, though there were individuals with abilities of 10 or 100 men, there should be no employment of them. I would make the people, while looking on death as a grievous thing, yet not remove elsewhere to avoid it. 2. Though they had boats and carriages, they should have no occasion to ride in them. Though they had buff coats and sharp weapons, they should have no occasion to don or use them. 3. I would make the people return to the use of knotted cords instead of writing characters. 4. They should think so, coarse, food sweet, their plain clothes beautiful, their poor dwellings places of rest, and their common simple ways sources of enjoyment. 5. There should be a neighboring state within sight, and the voices of the fowls and dogs should be heard all the way from it to us. But I would make the people to old age, even to death, not have any intercourse with it. Chapter 81. 1. Sincere words are not fine. Fine words are not sincere. Those who are skilled in the Tao do not dispute about it. The disputatious are not skilled in it. Those who know the Tao are not extensively learned. The extensively learned do not know it. 2. The sage does not accumulate for himself. The more that he expends for others, the more does he possess of his own. The more that he gives to others, the more does he have himself. 3. With all sharpness of the way of heaven, it injures not. With all the doing in the way of the sage, he does not strive. The end. And thank you for listening to Lao Tzu, Tao Te Ching. Narrated by Alfred Costa. Copyright Strelbisky Multimedia Publishing, 2019.
Plato, The Republic. Narrated by Peter Coates. Persons of the Dialogue. Socrates, who is the narrator. Glaucon. Adeimantus. Polymarchus. Cephalus. Thrasymachus, Clitophon, and others who are mute auditors. The scene is laid in the house of Cephalus at the Piraeus, and the whole dialogue is narrated by Socrates the day after it actually took place to Timaeus, Hermocrates, Critias, and a nameless person who are introduced in the Timaeus. Book 1. I went down yesterday to the Piraeus with Glaucon the son of Ariston, that I might offer up my prayers to the goddess, Bendis, the Thracian Artemis, and also because I wanted to see in what manner they would celebrate the festival, which was a new thing. I was delighted with the procession of the inhabitants, but that of the Thracians was equally, if not more, beautiful. When we had finished our prayers and viewed the spectacle, we turned in the direction of the city, and at that instant Polymarchus, the son of Cephalus, chanced to catch sight of us from a distance as we were starting on our way home, and told his servant to run and bid us wait for him. The servant took hold of me by the cloak behind and said, "Polymarchus desires you to wait." I turned round and asked him where his master was. "There he is," said the youth, "coming after you, if you will only wait." "Certainly we will," said Glaucon, and in a few minutes Polymarchus appeared, and with him Adeimantus, Glaucon's brother, Nicaratus, the son of Nicias, and several others who had been at the procession. Polymarchus said to me, "I perceive, Socrates, that you and your companion are already on your way to the city." "You are not far wrong," I said. "But do you see," he rejoined, "how many we are?" "Of course." And are you stronger than all these? For if not, you will have to remain where you are. May there not be the alternative, I said, that we may persuade you to let us go? But can you persuade us if we refuse to listen to you, he said. Certainly not, replied Glaucon. Then we are not going to listen, of that you may be assured. Adeimantus added, has no one told you of the torch race on horseback in honour of the goddess which will take place in the evening? With horses, I replied, that is a novelty. Will horsemen carry torches and pass them one to another during the race? Yes, said Polymarchus, and not only so, but a festival will be celebrated at night, which you certainly ought to see. Let us rise soon after supper and see this festival. There will be a large gathering of young men, and we will have a good talk. Stay, then, and do not be perverse. Glaucon said, I suppose, since you insist, that we must. Very good, I replied. Accordingly, we went with Polymarchus to his house, and there we found his brothers Lysias and Euthydemus, and with them Thrasymachus the Chalcedonian, Charmantides the Paineian, and Clitophon the son of Aristonymus. There too was Cephalus, the father of Polymarchus, whom I had not seen for a long time, and I thought him very much aged. He was seated on a cushioned chair, and had a garland on his head, for he had been sacrificing in the court, and there were some other chairs in the room arranged in a semicircle, upon which we sat down by him. He saluted me eagerly, and then he said, You don't come to see me, Socrates, as often as you ought. If I were still able to go and see you, I would not ask you to come to me. But at my age I can hardly get to the city, and therefore you should come oftener to the Piraeus. For let me tell you, that the more the pleasures of the body fade away, the greater to me is the pleasure and charm of conversation. Do not then deny my request, but make our house your resort, and keep company with these young men. We are old friends, and you will be quite at home with us. I replied, There is nothing which, for my part, I like better, Cephalus, than conversing with aged men, for I regard them as travellers who have gone a journey which I too may have to go, and of whom I ought to inquire whether the way is smooth and easy or rugged and difficult. And this is a question which I should like to ask of you, who have arrived at that time which the poets call the threshold of old age. Is life harder towards the end, or what report do you give of it? I will tell you, Socrates, he said, what my own feeling is. Men of my age flock together. We are birds of a feather, as the old proverb says. And at our meetings the tale of my acquaintance commonly is, I cannot eat, I cannot drink. The pleasures of youth and love are fled away. There was a good time once, but now that is gone, and life is no longer life. Some complain of the slights which are put upon them by relations, and they will tell you sadly of how many evils their old age is the cause. But to me, Socrates, these complainers seem to blame that which is not really in fault. For if old age were the cause, I too being old, and every other old man, would have felt as they do. But this is not my own experience, nor that of others whom I have known. How well I remember the aged poet Sophocles, when in answer to the question, How does love suit with age, Sophocles? Are you still the man you were? Peace, he replied, most gladly have I escaped the thing of which you speak. I feel as if I had escaped from a mad and furious master. His words have often occurred to my mind since, and they seem as good to me now as at the time when he uttered them. For certainly old age has a great sense of calm and freedom. When the passions relax their hold, then, as Sophocles says, we are freed from the grasp not of one mad master only, but of many. The truth is, Socrates, that these regrets, and also the complaints about relations, are to be attributed to the same cause, which is not old age, but men's characters and tempers. For he who is of a calm and happy nature will hardly feel the pressure of age, but to him who is of an opposite disposition youth and age are equally a burden. I listened in admiration, and wanting to draw him out, that he might go on, Yes, Cephalus, I said, but I rather suspect that people in general are not convinced by you when you speak thus. They think that old age sits lightly upon you not because of your happy disposition, but because you are rich, and wealth is well known to be a great comforter. You are right, he replied, they are not convinced, and there is something in what they say, Not, however, so much as they imagine. I might answer them as Themistocles answered the Seriphian who was abusing him and saying that he was famous, not for his own merits, but because he was an Athenian. If you had been a native of my country or I of yours, neither of us would have been famous. And to those who are not rich and are impatient of old age, the same reply may be made. For to the good poor man old age cannot be a light burden, nor can a bad rich man ever have peace with himself. May I ask, Cephalus, whether your fortune was for the most part inherited or acquired by you? Acquired, Socrates. Do you want to know how much I acquired? In the art of making money I have been midway between my father and grandfather. For my grandfather, whose name I bear, doubled and trebled the value of his patrimony, that which he inherited being much what I possess now. But my father, Lysanias, reduced the property below what it is at present, and I shall be satisfied if I leave to these my sons not less but a little more than I received. That was why I asked you the question, I replied, because I see that you are indifferent about money, which is a characteristic rather of those who have inherited their fortunes than of those who have acquired them. The makers of fortunes have a second love of money as a creation of their own, resembling the affection of authors for their own poems, or of parents for their children, besides that natural love of it for the sake of use and profit which is common to them and all men. And hence they are very bad company, for they can talk about nothing but the praises of wealth. That is true, he said. Yes, that is very true, but may I ask you another question? What do you consider to be the greatest blessing which you have reaped from your wealth? One, he said, of which I could not expect easily to convince others. For let me tell you, Socrates, that when a man thinks himself to be near death, fears and cares enter into his mind which he never had before, the tales of a world below, and the punishment which is exacted there of deeds done here were once a laughing matter to him, but now he is tormented with the thought that they may be true, either from the weakness of age, or because he is now drawing nearer to that other place. He has a clearer view of these things. Suspicions and alarms crowd thickly upon him, and he begins to reflect and consider what wrongs he has done to others. And when he finds that the sum of his transgressions is great, he will many a time, like a child, start up in his sleep for fear, and he is filled with dark forebodings. But to him who is conscious of no sin, sweet hope, as Pindar charmingly says, is the kind nurse of his age. Hope, he says, cherishes the soul of him who lives in justice and holiness, and is the nurse of his age and the companion of his journey. Hope which is mightiest to sway the restless soul of man. How admirable are his words, and the great blessing of riches, I do not say to every man, but to a good man, is that he has had no occasion to deceive or to defraud others, either intentionally or unintentionally, and when he departs to the world below, he is not in any apprehension about offerings due to the gods or debts which he owes to men. Now, to this peace of mind, the possession of wealth greatly contributes, and therefore I say that, setting one thing against another, of the many advantages which wealth has to give, to a man of sense this is in my opinion the greatest. Well said, Cephalus, I replied. But as concerning justice, what is it? To speak the truth and to pay your debts, no more than this? And even to this are there not exceptions? Suppose that a friend, when in his right mind, has deposited alms with me, and he asks for them when he is not in his right mind. Ought I to give them back to him? No one would say that I ought, or that I should be right in doing so, any more than they would say that I ought always to speak the truth to one who is in his condition. You are quite right, he replied. But then, I said, speaking the truth and paying your debts is not a correct definition of justice. Quite correct, Socrates. If Simonides is to be believed, said Polemarchus, interposing. I fear, said Cephalus, that I must go now, for I have to look after the sacrifices, and I hand over the argument to Polemarchus and the company. Is not Polemarchus your heir? I said. To be sure, he answered, and went away laughing to the sacrifices. Tell me then, O thou heir of the argument, what did Simonides say, and according to you truly say, about justice? He said that the repayment of a debt is just, and in saying so he appears to me to be right. I should be sorry to doubt the word of such a wise and inspired man, but his meaning, though probably clear to you, is the reverse of clear to me. For he certainly does not mean, as we were just now saying, that I ought to return a deposit of alms or of anything else to one who asks for it, when he is not in his right senses. And yet a deposit cannot be denied to be a debt.
True.
Then when the person who asks me is not in his right mind, I am by no means to make the return?
Certainly not.
When Simonides said that the repayment of a debt was justice, did he not mean to include that case?
Certainly not,
for he thinks that a friend ought always to do good to a friend and never evil. You mean that the return of a deposit of gold, which is to the injury of the receiver if the two parties are friends, is not the repayment of a debt? That is what you would imagine him to say?
Yes.
And are enemies also to receive what we owe to them?
To be sure, he said, they are to receive what we owe them, and an enemy, as I take it, owes to an enemy that which is due or proper to him, that is to say, evil.
Simonides, then, after the manner of poets, would seem to have spoken darkly of the nature of justice, for he really meant to say that justice is the giving to each man what is proper to him, and this he termed a debt.
That must have been his meaning, he said.
By heaven, I replied, and if we asked him what due or proper thing is given by medicine, and to whom, what answer do you think he would make to us?
He would surely reply that medicine gives drugs and meat and drink to human bodies.
And what due or proper thing is given by cookery, and to what?
Seasoning to food.
And what is that which justice gives, and to whom?
If, Socrates, we are to be guided at all by the analogy of the preceding instances, then justice is the art which gives good to friends and evil to enemies.
That is his meaning, then?
I think so.
And who is best able to do good to his friends and evil to his enemies in time of sickness?
The physician.
Or when they are on a voyage amid the perils of the sea?
The pilot.
And in what sort of actions, or with a view to what result, is the just man most able to do harm to his enemy and good to his friend?
In going to war against the one and in making alliances with the other.
But when a man is well, my dear Polemarchus, there is no need of a physician.
No.
And he who is not on a voyage has no need of a pilot.
No.
Then in time of peace, justice will be of no use.
I am very far from thinking so.
You think that justice may be of use in peace as well as in war?
Yes.
Like husbandry for the acquisition of corn?
Yes.
Or like shoemaking for the acquisition of shoes, that is what you mean?
Yes.
And what similar use or power of acquisition has justice in time of peace?
In contracts, Socrates, justice is of use.
And by contracts you mean partnerships?
Exactly.
But is the just man or the skillful player a more useful and better partner at a game of draughts?
The skillful player.
And in the laying of bricks and stones, is the just man a more useful or better partner than the builder?
Quite the reverse.
Then in what sort of partnership is the just man a better partner than the harp player?
As in playing the harp player is certainly a better partner than the just man.
In a money partnership?
Yes, Polemarchus, but surely not in the use of money,
for you do not want a just man to be your counsellor in the purchase or sale of a horse.
A man who is knowing about horses would be better for that, would he not?
Certainly.
And when you want to buy a ship, the shipwright or the pilot would be better.
True.
Then what is the joint use of silver or gold in which the just man is to be preferred?
When you want to make a deposit to be kept safely.
You mean when money is not wanted but allowed to lie?
Precisely.
That is to say, justice is useful when money is useless.
That is the inference.
And when you want to keep a pruning hook safe, then justice is useful to the individual and to the state. But when you want to use it, then the art of the vine dresser.
Clearly.
And when you want to keep a shield or a lyre and not to use them, you would say that justice is useful, but when you want to use them, then the art of the soldier or of the musician.
Certainly.
And so of all other things, justice is useful when they are useless, and useless when they are useful. That is the inference. Then justice is not good for much. But let us consider this further point. Is not he who can best strike a blow in a boxing match or in any kind of fighting best able to ward off a blow? Certainly. And he who is most skillful in preventing or escaping from a disease is best able to create one? True. And he is the best guard of a camp who is best able to steal a march upon the enemy? Certainly. Then he who is a good keeper of anything is also a good thief? That, I suppose, is to be inferred. Then, if the just man is good at keeping money, he is good at stealing it. That is implied in the argument. Then, after all, the just man has turned out to be a thief. And this is a lesson which I suspect you must have learnt out of Homer. For he, speaking of Autolycus, the maternal grandfather of Odysseus, who is a favourite of his, affirms that he was excellent above all men in theft and perjury. And so you and Homer and Simonides are agreed that justice is an art of theft, to be practised, however, for the good of friends and for the harm of enemies. That was what you were saying? No, certainly not that, though I do not now know what I did say, but I'd still stand by the latter words. Well, there is another question. By friends and enemies, do we mean those who are so really, or only in seeming? Surely, he said, a man may be expected to love those whom he thinks good, and to hate those whom he thinks evil. Yes, but do not persons often err about good and evil? Many who are not good seem to be so, and conversely. That is true. Then to them the good will be enemies, and the evil will be their friends. True. And in that case they will be right in doing good to the evil and evil to the good. Clearly. But the good are just and would not do an injustice. True. Then according to your argument, it is just to injure those who do no wrong. Nay, Socrates, the doctrine is immoral. Then I suppose that we ought to do good to the just and harm to the unjust. I like that better. But see the consequence. Many a man who is ignorant of human nature has friends who are bad friends, and in that case he ought to do harm to them, and he has good enemies whom he ought to benefit. But if so, we shall be saying the very opposite of that which we affirm to be the meaning of Simonides. Very true, he said, and I think that we had better correct an error into which we seem to have fallen in the use of the words friend and enemy. What was the error, Polymarchus? I asked. We assumed that he is a friend who seems to be or who is thought good. And how is the error to be corrected? We should rather say that he is a friend who is, as well as seems, good, and that he who seems only and is not good only seems to be and is not a friend, and of an enemy the same may be said. You would argue that the good are our friends and the bad our enemies. Yes. And instead of saying simply, as we did at first, that it is just to do good to our friends and harm to our enemies, we should further say, it is just to do good to our friends when they are good, and harm to our enemies when they are evil. Yes, that appears to me to be the truth. But ought the just to injure anyone at all? Undoubtedly he ought to injure those who are both wicked and his enemies. When horses are injured, are they improved or deteriorated? The latter. Deteriorated, that is to say, in the good qualities of horses, not of dogs. Yes, of horses. And dogs are deteriorated in the good qualities of dogs, and not of horses. Of course. And will not men who are injured be deteriorated in that which is the proper virtue of man? Certainly. And that human virtue is justice? To be sure. Then men who are injured are of necessity made unjust. That is the result. But can the musician by his art make men unmusical? Certainly not. Or the horseman by his art make them bad horsemen? Impossible. And can the just by justice make men unjust, or speaking generally, can the good by virtue make them bad? Assuredly not. Any more than heat can produce cold? It cannot. Or drought moisture? Certainly not. Nor can the good harm anyone. Impossible. And the just is the good. Certainly. Then to injure a friend or anyone else is not the act of a just man, but of the opposite, who is the unjust. I think what you say is quite true, Socrates. Then if a man says that justice consists in the repayment of debts, and that good is the debt which a just man owes to his friends, and evil the debt which he owes to his enemies, to say this is not wise, for it is not true, if, as has been clearly shown, the injuring of another can be in no case just.
I agree with you, said Polymarchus.
Then you and I are prepared to take up arms against anyone who attributes such a saying to Simonides, or Bias, or Pittacus, or any other wise man or seer.
I am quite ready to do battle at your side, he said.
Shall I tell you whose I believe the saying to be?
Whose?
I believe that Periander, or Perdiccas, or Xerxes, or Ismenius the Theban, or some other rich and mighty man who had a great opinion of his power, was the first to say that justice is doing good to your friends and harm to your enemies.
Most true, he said.
Yes, I said, but if this definition of justice also breaks down, what other can be offered? Several times in the course of the discussion, Thrasymachus had made an attempt to get the argument into his own hands, and had been put down by the rest of the company, who wanted to hear the end. But when Polymarchus and I had done speaking and there was a pause, he could no longer hold his peace, and gathering himself up, he came at us like a wild beast seeking to devour us. We were quite panic-stricken at the sight of him. He roared out to the whole company, "What folly, Socrates, has taken possession of you all, and why, silly billies, do you knock under to one another? I say that if you want really to know what justice is, you should not only ask, but answer, and you should not seek honour to yourself from the refutation of an opponent, but have your own answer, for there is many a one who can ask and cannot answer. And now I will not have you say that justice is duty or advantage or profit or gain or interest, for this sort of nonsense will not do for me. I must have clearness and accuracy." I was panic-stricken at his words, and could not look at him without trembling. Indeed, I believed that if I had not fixed my eye upon him, I should have been struck dumb. But when I saw his fury rising, I looked at him first, and was therefore able to reply to him. "Thrasymachus," I said with a quiver, "don't be hard upon us. Polymarchus and I may have been guilty of a little mistake in the argument, but I can assure you that the error was not intentional. If we were seeking for a piece of gold, you would not imagine that we were knocking under to one another, and so losing our chance of finding it. And why, when we are seeking for justice, a thing more precious than many pieces of gold, do you say that we are weakly yielding to one another and not doing our utmost to get at the truth? Nay, my good friend, we are most willing and anxious to do so. But the fact is that we cannot, and if so, you people who know all things should pity us and not be angry with us."
"How characteristic of Socrates," he replied with a bitter laugh. "That's your ironical style. Did I not foresee? Have I not already told you that whatever he was asked he would refuse to answer, and try irony or any other shuffle in order that he might avoid answering?"
"You are a philosopher, Thrasymachus," I replied, "and well know that if you ask a person what numbers make up 12, taking care to prohibit him whom you ask from answering twice 6, or 3 times 4, or 6 times 2, or 4 times 3, for this sort of nonsense will not do for me, then obviously, if that is your way of putting the question, no one can answer you. But suppose that he were to retort, 'Thrasymachus, what do you mean? If one of these numbers which you interdict to be the true answer to the question, am I falsely to say some other number which is not the right one? Is that your meaning? How would you answer him?'
'Just as if the two cases were at all alike,' he said.
'Why should they not be?' I replied. 'And even if they are not, but only appear to be so to the person who is asked, ought he not to say what he thinks, whether you and I forbid him or not?'
'I presume that then you are going to make one of the interdicted answers.'
'I dare say that I may, notwithstanding the danger, if upon reflection I approve of any of them.'
'But what if I give you an answer about justice other and better,' he said, 'than any of these? What do you deserve to have done to you?'
'Done to me? As becomes the ignorant, I must learn from the wise. That is what I deserve to have done to me.'
'What, and no payment? A pleasant notion.'
'I will pay you when I have the money,' I replied.
"'But you have, Socrates,' said Glaucon,
And you, Thrasymachus, need to be under no anxiety about money, for we will all make a contribution for Socrates.
Yes, he replied, and then Socrates will do as he always does, refuse to answer himself, but take and pull to pieces the answer of someone else.
Why, my good friend, I said, how can anyone answer who knows and says that he knows just nothing, and who, even if he has some faint notions of his own, is told by a man of authority not to utter them? The natural thing is that the speaker should be someone like yourself who professes to know and can tell what he knows. Will you then kindly answer for the edification of the company and of myself?
Glaucon and the rest of the company joined in my request, and Thrasymachus, as anyone might see, was in reality eager to speak, for he thought that he had an excellent answer and would distinguish himself. But at first he affected to insist on my answering. At length he consented to begin. Behold, he said, the wisdom of Socrates. He refuses to teach himself, and goes about learning of others, to whom he never even says thank you.
That I learn of others, I replied, is quite true, but that I am ungrateful I wholly deny. Money I have none, and therefore I pay in praise, which is all I have, and how ready I am to praise anyone who appears to me to speak well, and you will very soon find out when you answer, for I expect that you will answer well.
Listen, then, he said. I proclaim that justice is nothing else than the interest of the stronger. And now why do you not praise me? But of course you won't.
Let me first understand you, I replied. Justice, as you say, is the interest of the stronger. What, Thrasymachus, is the meaning of this? You cannot mean to say that because Polydamas, the Pancratiast, is stronger than we are, and finds the eating of beef conducive to his bodily strength, that to eat beef is therefore equally for our good who are weaker than he is, and right and just for us.
That's abominable of you, Socrates. You take the words in the sense which is most damaging to the argument.
Not at all, my good sir, I said. I am trying to understand them, and I wish that you would be a little clearer.
Well, he said, have you never heard that forms of government differ? There are tyrannies, and there are democracies, and there are aristocracies.
Yes, I know.
And the government is the ruling power in each state?
Certainly.
And the differing forms of government make laws democratical, aristocratical, tyrannical, with a view to their several interests, and these laws, which are made by them for their own interests, are the justice which they deliver to their subjects, and him who transgresses them they punish as a breaker of the law and unjust. And that is what I mean when I say that in all states there is the same principle of justice, which is the interest of the government, and as the government must be supposed to have power, the only reasonable conclusion is that everywhere there is one principle of justice, which is the interest of the stronger.
Now I understand you, I said, and whether you are right or not, I will try to discover. But let me remark that in defining justice you have yourself used the word interest, which you forbade me to use. It is true, however, that in your definition the words of the stronger are added.
A small addition, you must allow, he said.
Great or small, never mind about that. We must first inquire whether what you are saying is the truth. Now, we are both agreed that justice is interest of some sort, but you go on to say of the stronger. About this addition, I am not so sure and must therefore consider further.
Proceed.
I will, and first tell me, do you admit that it is just for subjects to obey their rulers?
I do.
But are the rulers of states absolutely infallible, or are they sometimes liable to err?
To be sure, he replied, they are liable to err.
Then, in making their laws, they may sometimes make them rightly, and sometimes not.
True.
When they make them rightly, they make them agreeably to their interest. When they are mistaken, contrary to their interest. You admit that?
Yes.
And the laws which they make must be obeyed by their subjects, and that is what you call justice.
Doubtless.
Then justice, according to your argument, is not only obedience to the interest of the stronger, but the reverse.
What is it that you are saying? He asked.
I am only repeating what you are saying, I believe. But let us consider, have we not admitted that the rulers may be mistaken about their own interest in what they command, and also that to obey them is justice? Has that not been admitted? Yes. Then you must also have acknowledged justice not to be for the interest of the stronger when the rulers unintentionally command things to be done which are to their own injury. For if, as you say, justice is the obedience which the subject renders to their commands, in that case, O wisest of men, is there any escape from the conclusion that the weaker are commanded to do not what is for the interest, but what is for the injury of the stronger? Nothing can be clearer, Socrates, said Polymarchus. Yes, said Clitophon, interposing, if you are allowed to be his witness. But there is no need of any witness, said Polymarchus, for Thrasymachus himself acknowledges that rulers may sometimes command what is not for their own interest, and that for subjects to obey them is justice. Yes, Polymarchus, Thrasymachus said that for subjects to do what was commanded by their rulers is just. Yes, Clitophon, but he also said that justice is the interest of the stronger, and while admitting both these propositions, he further acknowledged that the stronger may command the weaker who are his subjects to do what is not for his own interest, whence follows that justice is the injury quite as much as the interest of the stronger. But, said Clitophon, he meant by the interest of the stronger what the stronger thought to be his interest. This was what the weaker had to do, and this was affirmed by him to be justice. Those were not his words, rejoined Polymarchus. Never mind, I replied. If he now says that they are, let us accept his statement. Tell me, Thrasymachus, I said, did you mean by justice what the stronger thought to be his interest, whether really so or not?
Certainly not, he said. Do you suppose that I call him who is mistaken the stronger at the time when he is mistaken?
Yes, I said, my impression was that you did so, when you admitted that the ruler was not infallible but might be sometimes mistaken.
You argue like an informer, Socrates. Do you mean, for example, that he who is mistaken about the sick is a physician in that he is mistaken, or that he who errs in arithmetic or grammar is an arithmetician or grammarian at the time when he is making the mistake in respect of the mistake? True, we say that the physician or arithmetician or grammarian has made a mistake, but this is only a way of speaking, for the fact is that neither the grammarian nor any other person of skill ever makes a mistake in so far as he is what his name implies. They none of them err unless their skill fails them, and then they cease to be skilled artists. No artist or sage or ruler errs at the time when he is what his name implies, though he is commonly said to err, and I adopted the common mode of speaking. But to be perfectly accurate, since you are such a lover of accuracy, we should say that the ruler, in so far as he is a ruler, is unerring, and being unerring always commands that which is for his own interest, and the subject is required to execute his commands, and therefore, as I said at first and now repeat, justice is the interest of the stronger. Indeed, Thrasymachus, and do I really appear to you to argue like an informer?
Certainly, he replied.
And do you suppose that I ask these questions with any design of injuring you in the argument?
Nay, he replied. Suppose is not the word, I know it, but you will be found out, and by sheer force of argument you will never prevail.
I shall not make the attempt, my dear man, but to avoid any misunderstanding occurring between us in future, let me ask, in what sense do you speak of a ruler or stronger whose interest, as you were saying, he being the superior, it is just that the inferior should execute? Is he a ruler in the popular or in the strict sense of the term?
In the strictest of all senses, he said. And now cheat and play the informer if you can. I ask no quarter at your hands, but you will never be able, never.
And do you imagine, I said, that I am such a madman as to try and cheat Thrasymachus? I might as well shave a lion.
Why, he said, you made an attempt a minute ago and you failed.
Enough, I said, of these civilities. It will be better that I should ask you a question. Is the physician, taken in the strict sense of which you are speaking, a healer of the sick or a maker of money? And remember that I am now speaking of the true physician.
A healer of the sick, he replied.
And the pilot, that is to say, the true pilot, is he a captain of sailors or a mere sailor?
A captain of sailors.
The circumstance that he sails in the ship is not to be taken into account? neither is he to be called a sailor. The name pilot by which he is distinguished has nothing to do with sailing, but is significant of his skill and his authority over the sailors.
Very true, he said.
Now, I said, every art has an interest.
Certainly.
For which the art has to consider and provide.
Yes, that is the aim of art.
And the interest of any art is the perfection of it, this and nothing else.
What do you mean?
I mean what I may illustrate negatively by the example of the body. Suppose you were to ask me whether the body is self-sufficing or has wants. I should reply, certainly the body has wants, for the body may be ill and require to be cured, and has therefore interests to which the art of medicine ministers. And this is the origin and intention of medicine, as you will acknowledge. Am I not right?
Quite right, he replied.
But is the art of medicine or any other art faulty or deficient in any quality in the same way that the eye may be deficient in sight or the ear fail of hearing, and therefore requires another art to provide for the interests of seeing and hearing? Has art in itself, I say, any similar liability to fault or defect? And does every art require another supplementary art to provide for its interests, and that another and another without end? Or have the arts to look only after their own interests, or have they no need either of themselves or of another? Having no faults or defects, they have no need to correct them, either by the exercise of their own art or of any other. They have only to consider the interest of their subject matter. For every art remains pure and faultless while remaining true, that is to say, while perfect and unimpaired. Take the words in your precise sense and tell me whether I am not right.
Yes, clearly.
Then medicine does not consider the interest of medicine, but the interest of the body.
True, he said.
Nor does the art of horsemanship consider the interests of the art of horsemanship, but the interests of the horse. Neither do any other arts care for themselves, for they have no needs. They care only for that which is the subject of their art.
True, he said.
But surely, Thrasymachus, the arts are the superiors and rulers of their own subjects. To this he assented with a good deal of reluctance. Then, I said, no science or art considers or enjoins the interest of the stronger or superior, but only the interest of the subject and weaker. He made an attempt to contest this proposition also, but finally acquiesced. Then, I continued, no physician, in so far as he is a physician, considers his own good in what he prescribes, but the good of his patient. For the true physician is also a ruler having the human body as a subject, and is not a mere money-maker. That has been admitted?
Yes.
And the pilot, likewise, in the strict sense of the term, is a ruler of sailors and not a mere sailor.
That has been admitted.
And such a pilot and ruler will provide and prescribe for the interest of the sailor who is under him, and not for his own or the ruler's interest.
He gave a reluctant yes.
Then, I said, Thrasymachus, there is no one in any rule who, in so far as he is a ruler, considers or enjoins what is for his own interest, but always what is for the interest of his subject or suitable to his art. To that he looks, and that alone he considers in everything which he says and does.
When we got to this point in the argument, and everyone saw that the definition of justice had been completely upset, Thrasymachus, instead of replying to me, said, "Tell me, Socrates, have you got a nurse?"
"Why do you ask such a question," I said, "when you ought rather to be answering?"
"Because she leaves you to snivel and never wipes your nose. She has not even taught you to know the shepherd from the sheep."
"What makes you say that?" I replied.
"Because you fancy that the shepherd or neatherd fattens or tends the sheep or oxen with a view to their own good and not to the good of himself or his master. And you further imagine that the rulers of states, if they are true rulers, never think of their subjects as sheep, and that they are not studying their own advantage day and night. Oh, no, and so entirely astray are you in your ideas about the just and unjust, as not even to know that justice and the just are in reality another's good.
that is to say, the interest of the ruler and stronger, and the loss of the subject and servant, and injustice the opposite. For the unjust is lord over the truly simple and just. He is the stronger, and his subjects do what is for his interest, and minister to his happiness, which is very far from being their own. Consider further, most foolish Socrates, that the just is always a loser in comparison with the unjust. First of all, in private contracts, wherever the unjust is the partner of the just, you will find that, when the partnership is dissolved, the unjust man has always more, and the just less. Secondly, in their dealings with the state, when there is an income tax, the just man will pay more, and the unjust less on the same amount of income. And when there is anything to be received, the one gains nothing, and the other much. Observe also what happens when they take an office. There is the just man neglecting his affairs and perhaps suffering other losses, and getting nothing out of the public, because he is just. Moreover, he is hated by his friends and acquaintance for refusing to serve them in unlawful ways. But all this is reversed in the case of the unjust man. I am speaking, as before, of injustice on a large scale in which the advantage of the unjust is most apparent, and my meaning will be most clearly seen if we turn to that highest form of injustice in which the criminal is the happiest of men, and the sufferers or those who refuse to do injustice are the most miserable. That is to say, tyranny, which by fraud and force takes away the property of others, not little by little but wholesale, comprehending in one things sacred as well as profane, private and public, for which acts of wrong, if he were detected perpetrating any one of them singly, he would be punished and incur great disgrace. They who do such wrong in particular cases are called robbers of temples, and man-stealers and burglars and swindlers and thieves. But when a man, besides taking away the money of the citizens, has made slaves of them, then, instead of these names of reproach, he is termed happy and blessed, not only by the citizens, but by all who hear of his having achieved the consummation of injustice. For mankind censure injustice, fearing that they may be the victims of it, and not because they shrink from committing it. And thus, as I have shown, Socrates, injustice, when on a sufficient scale, has more strength and freedom and mastery than justice. And, as I said at first, justice is in the interest of the stronger, whereas injustice is a man's own profit and interest. Thrasymachus, when he had thus spoken, having, like a bathman, deluged our ears with his words, had a mind to go away, but the company would not let him. They insisted that he should remain and defend his position, and I myself added my own humble request that he would not leave us. Thrasymachus, I said to him, excellent man, how suggestive are your remarks, and are you going to run away before you have fairly taught or learned whether they are true or not? Is the attempt to determine the way of man's life so small a matter in your eyes, to determine how life may be passed by each one of us to the greatest advantage? And do I differ from you, he said, as to the importance of the inquiry? You appear rather, I said, to have no care or thought about us, Thrasymachus. Whether we live better or worse from not knowing what you say you know, is to you a matter of indifference. Prithee, friend, do not keep your knowledge to yourself. We are a large party, and any benefit which you confer upon us will be amply rewarded. For my own part, I openly declare that I am not convinced, and that I do not believe injustice to be more gainful than justice, even if uncontrolled and allowed to have free play. For, granting that there may be an unjust man who is able to commit injustice either by fraud or force, still this does not convince me of the superior advantage of injustice. And there may be others who are in the same predicament with myself. Perhaps we may be wrong. If so, you in your wisdom should convince us that we are mistaken in preferring justice to injustice. And how am I to convince you, he said, if you are not already convinced by what I have just said? What more can I do for you? Would you have me put the proof bodily into your souls? Heaven forbid, I said. I would only ask you to be consistent, or, if you change, change openly and let there be no deception. For I must remark, Thrasymachus, if you will recall what was previously said, that although you began by defining the true physician in an exact sense, you did not observe a like exactness when speaking of the shepherd. You thought that the shepherd, as a shepherd, tends the sheep not with a view to their own good, but like a mere diner or banqueter with a view to the pleasures of the table, or again as a trader for sale in the market, and not as a shepherd. Yet surely the art of the shepherd is concerned only with the good of his subjects. He has only to provide the best for them, since the perfection of the art is already ensured whenever all the requirements of it are satisfied. And that was what I was saying just now about the ruler. I conceived that the art of the ruler, considered as ruler, whether in a state or in private life, could only regard the good of his flock or subjects, whereas you seem to think that the rulers in states, that is to say the true rulers, like being in authority.
Think? Nay, I am sure of it.
Then why in the case of lesser offices do men never take them willingly without payment, unless under the idea that they govern for the advantage not of themselves, but of others? Let me ask you a question. Are not the several arts different, by reason of their each having a separate function? And, my dear illustrious friend, do say what you think, that we may make a little progress.
Yes, that is the difference, he replied.
And each art gives us a particular good and not merely a general one. Medicine, for example, gives us health, navigation, safety at sea, and so on. Yes, he said. And the art of payment has the special function of giving pay. But we do not confuse this with other arts any more than the art of the pilot is to be confused with the art of medicine, because the health of the pilot may be improved by a sea voyage. You would not be inclined to say, would you, that navigation is the art of medicine, at least if we are to adopt your exact use of language?
Certainly not.
Or because a man is in good health when he receives pay, you would not say that the art of payment is medicine?
I should not.
Nor would you say that medicine is the art of receiving pay because a man takes fees when he is engaged in healing?
Certainly not.
And we have admitted, I said, that the good of each art is specially confined to the art.
Yes.
Then, if there be any good which all artists have in common, that is to be attributed to something of which they all have the common use.
True,
he replied. And when the artist is benefited by receiving pay, the advantage is gained by an additional use of the art of pay, which is not the art professed by him. He gave a reluctant assent to this. Then the pay is not derived by the several artists from their respective arts. But the truth is that while the art of medicine gives health, the art of the builder builds a house. Another art attends to them, which is the art of pay. The various arts may be doing their own business and benefiting that over which they preside. But would the artist receive any benefit from his art unless he were paid as well?
I suppose not.
But does he therefore confer no benefit when he works for nothing?
Certainly he confers a benefit.
Then now, Thrasymachus, there is no longer any doubt that neither arts nor governments provide for their own interests. But, as we were before saying, they rule and provide for the interests of their subjects who are the weaker and not the stronger. To their good they attend and not to the good of the superior. And this is the reason, my dear Thrasymachus, why, as I was just now saying, no one is willing to govern, because no one likes to take in hand the reformation of evils which are not his concern without remuneration. For in the execution of his work, and in giving his orders to another, the true artist does not regard his own interest, but always that of his subjects, and therefore in order that rulers may be willing to rule, they must be paid in one of three modes of payment, money, or honour, or a penalty for refusing.
What do you mean, Socrates? Said Glaucon. The first two modes of payment are intelligible enough, but what the penalty is I do not understand, or how a penalty can be a payment.
You mean that you do not understand the nature of this payment, which to the best men is the great inducement to rule. Of course you know that ambition and avarice are held to be, as indeed they are, a disgrace.
Very true.
And for this reason, I said, money and honour have no attraction for them. Good men do not wish to be openly demanding payment for governing, and so to get the name of hirelings, nor by secretly helping themselves out of the public revenues to get the name of thieves. and not being ambitious, they do not care about honour. Wherefore necessity must be laid upon them, and they must be induced to serve from the fear of punishment. And this, as I imagine, is the reason why the forwardness to take office, instead of waiting to be compelled, has been deemed dishonourable. Now the worst part of the punishment is that he who refuses to rule is liable to be ruled by one who is worse than himself, and the fear of this, as I conceive, induces the good to take office, not because they would, but because they cannot help, not under the idea that they are going to have any benefit or enjoyment themselves, but as a necessity, and because they are not able to commit the task of ruling to anyone who is better than themselves, or indeed as good. For there is reason to think that if a city were composed entirely of good men, then to avoid office would be as much an object of contention as to obtain offices at present. Then we should have plain proof that the true ruler is not meant by nature to regard his own interest, but that of his subjects. And everyone who knew this would choose rather to receive a benefit from another than to have the trouble of conferring one. So far am I from agreeing with Thrasymachus that justice is in the interest of the stronger. This latter question need not be further discussed at present, but when Thrasymachus says that the life of the unjust is more advantageous than that of the just, his new statement appears to me of a far more serious character. Which of us has spoken truly, and what sort of life, Glaucon, do you prefer?
I, for my part, deem the life of the just to be the more advantageous, he answered.
Did you hear all the advantages of the unjust which Thrasymachus was rehearsing?
Yes, I heard him, he replied, but he has not convinced me.
Then we shall try to find some way of convincing him, if we can, that he is saying what is not true.
Most certainly, he replied.
If, I said, he makes a set speech and we make another recounting all the advantages of being just, and he answers and we rejoin, there must be a numbering and measuring of the goods which are claimed on either side, and in the end we shall want judges to decide. But if we proceed in our inquiry as we lately did, by making admissions to one another, we shall unite the offices of judge and advocate in our own persons.
Very good, he said.
And to which method do I understand you to prefer, I said.
That which you propose.
Well then, Thrasymachus, I said, suppose you begin at the beginning and answer me. You say that perfect injustice is more gainful than perfect justice.
Yes, that is what I say, and I have given you my reasons.
And what is your view about them? Would you call one of them virtue and the other vice?
Certainly. I suppose that you would call justice virtue and injustice vice. What a charming notion! So likely, too, seeing that I affirm injustice to be profitable and justice not.
What else, then, would you say?
The opposite, he replied.
And would you call justice vice?
No, I would rather say sublime simplicity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.